is Dick's Sporting Goods Kickoff Week.
The 83rd season of football at Michigan Stadium begins in moments. And this edition of the Maize and Blue can't wait to enter the Big House. Last year, Michigan was 3-9, and this week has brought yet another challenge. A newspaper report alleging rules violations rocked the program and its head coach, Rich Rodriguez.
We know the rules and we comply by the rules. The perception sometimes that was out there that we did not care as much for our players' welfare, that is disheartening. To say that is misleading, inaccurate. And goes against everything that I've ever believed in coaching.
Today, Michigan will try to put the distractions aside and begin the 2009 campaign against Western Michigan. The Broncos are coming off a 9-4 record from last year. Good afternoon, everybody. Mike Patrick, Craig James. It's great to have you with us. There's enough controversy swirling around this program, the kind of thing that can tear a ball club apart, but it's the kind of thing that can also bring a ball club together. After being here a couple of days, what do we see?
Well, after yesterday's meetings with the players, I think we both answered that question, didn't we? We saw these football players and the leaders of the Michigan team look us in the eyes. And I really believe, as you do, that the Michigan team is behind Rich Rodriguez. They want him to be successful. They need him to be successful so they can be successful. No question in my mind, this has the ability to propel the Michigan football team back into a winning mode around here. They've used it as a building block, not as a stumbling block.
Well, of course, what makes it worse is last year's disastrous record, which was the worst in the history of the program. They've got to be better this year. That is, if you can play three quarterbacks and make it work, will that work?
Well, up until this week, that was the big question at Michigan. You know, who plays quarterback around here? They'll go with three different men. Young, true freshman Tate Forsey on the left. He gets the start. Nick Sheridan's a junior. Got a little experience under his belt. He'll have some plays, as will Denard Robinson. All three guys have a little different talent about them. They're all good. They're going to get snaps. But whoever gets hot, as any coach would do, Rich will keep that guy in there and let him run the football team.
All right, Craig. Quint Kessenich will work the sidelines for us. A little bit earlier, he had a chance to talk with the embattled coach, Rich Rodriguez.
Coach, given the nature of this week, the tumultuous, the drama-filled week, how would you best describe your team's preparation?
Well, they've had a great week. The focus has been outstanding. Our guys, you expect that in the first game week, and our guys have had a bounce in their step ever since Monday, and I think they're ready to play.
Openers are always important, but coming off a 3-9 season, how big is this game for you?
Well, every new season starts, your hope of something great in your program, and, you know, the first game's kind of set the tone. It's not the end-all to be-all, but at the same time, our guys are put a lot of tough work in the last 9 months. They've had a great camp, 3.5 weeks of camp, and they're ready to play against somebody and see where we're at.
Thanks, Coach.
Okay, thank
Mike.
Thank you, Quint. We're close to kickoff in Ann Arbor. For players on both sides, their moment has arrived.
It's time to blow it.
Scientific test proof. When you drink Dr. Pepper slow, 23.
Welcome back to the Big House. 106,201. This is the 83rd year they have been playing football in this facility. Michigan has won the toss. They defer. Western Michigan will receive the opening kickoff.
You think that Rich Rodriguez and this football team is excited about the chance to be on the football field and not having to talk about this and that and other than X's and O's.
They have been drooling over the prospect of this for quite a while.
It's like Santa Claus arrived this afternoon for Rich Rodriguez. He was carrying a pigskin.
The Michigan football team got a great welcome when they took the field. Be interesting to see the fans' reaction if they have adversity early against a pretty good Western Michigan football team.
You know, part of that, Mike, is Michigan's lucky that their fans understand and realize that they're playing against a Western Michigan team that's pretty darn good. So they're going to understand a little bit. They're expecting a victory, but they might be a little more lenient because they understand the opponent.
Brian Wright will kick off for Michigan. Brandon West, the starting running back, who is the career and single-season record holder, is back with Aaron Winchester. High end-over-end kick taken by Brandon West. Hit at the 15, dumped at the 17-yard line. Tim Hiller will run the Western Michigan offense. He has a chance to set every significant passing record in the history of this program and break several MAC records as well.
Mike, I think it's really important for Hiller today to be a star on this football field, both for himself individually and for the future, but for his football team. They need him to make good, quick decisions, getting rid of the football, giving this team a chance to move the chain.
A year ago, he hit nearly 65% of his throws, 3,700 plus yards, 36 touchdowns. And Hiller wants to throw on first down, goes underneath. It'll be a minimal gain, and he got it to Robert Arnheim. Who are your impact players here?
Well, obviously, Tim Hiller. We've been speaking about the young man. Good, quick, underneath decisions, getting rid of the football. He needs a go-to guy. Today, Juan Nunez, a little experience under his belt, has to make plays when the ball is coming his way. And then on defense, Austin Pritchard. He's a leader, and the front seven of that defense today has to be really mindful of Michigan's ground game.
Arnheim to the near side, Nunez to the top of your screen, and Brandon West is the tailback. West will get a carry behind that big offensive line and pick up two, maybe three, before Obiezie, the middle linebacker, makes the stop. You can see the lineups at the top of your screen as the Broncos will be facing a third down situation here on their opening possession at their own 23-yard line. They'll need about five. Receivers. Ansel Ponder, number eight, is in the slot. He's a freshman with great potential. Hiller looks that way, and Ponder can't make the catch as he's hit as soon as he touches it by Stevie Brown, who is now playing that hybrid linebacker position for Michigan. He was a starting safety a year ago.
One thing about Western Michigan's offense is that they play within that little box, that five-yard box. And if they're going to do that today with the athletes and the speed at Michigan's defense, it's going to be mighty hard for Western Michigan's receivers to get separation. They've got to execute, though, on third and five.
Ben Armour will punt it away. He was very inconsistent a year ago. And Greg Matthews, number 13, is deep to receive. He waits at his own 31-yard line. Nice high floating kick. Armour comes up, makes the fair catch. Excellent field position. Michigan will start at its own 48-yard line after a kick of only 30 yards.
The old Wolverines in the great movie, I love it. And when you look at that, Mike, and the X factor in this ball game, really it is the three quarterbacks. And which one of these threes will get the hot hand? Which one of the threes makes the right decisions at the line of scrimmage with their calls?
Puts a lot of pressure on those guys, too. Each battling for that starting job that they want to have. Forcier on the roll. completes a short pass. That's only about 4 yards and caught by Junior Hemingway, who had 6 grabs a year ago.
Part of the strategy today for Michigan's offense is to go really up-tempo at the line of scrimmage. So Forcier, although just a freshman, he's expected to get him to the line of scrimmage and make the quick call.
Big-time high school career. They'll go on the ground this time to Carlos Brown, number 23, who's playing in place of Brandon Miner, who suffered an ankle injury a week ago. Forcier was one of the top 5 dual threat quarterbacks coming out of high school, and with Nick Sheridan hurt in the spring, he got all the reps. Forcier eludes the first tackle, then 2 more, and reaches the 42-yard line, very close to a first down. Keith Dixon was the guy who had a shot at him in the backfield and missed it.
And you know, for me, when I'm watching a young man on the football field, this gives me an idea that he is under control, aware of the situation, stop, plants to come back to the inside. A lot of young men in a game for the first time don't see the game. They don't feel it. They can't be natural.
This is a very inexperienced defense for Western Michigan. They only have 3 starters from a year ago. There is a flag down. This could be a hold or a clip or a procedure penalty even, because they threw it right at the feet of Martavius Odoms, number 9. And he moved.
Illegal motion by the offense. Number 9, 5-yard penalty.
One of the challenges of an offense when you go up-tempo, obviously, is when you're young and you're still learning the offense, right, is that you have procedures. You have things like this happen. So it can go both ways.
Odoms had a great freshman year, young man out of Pahokee, Florida. Set the club record for catches and yards. And those numbers, 49 catches for 443, led the ball club in a down offensive year. Forcier on the option. Almost back to the original line of scrimmage, and Doug Wickens, the nickelback, free safety, along with Deontay LeGreer, who is a freshman middle linebacker, were in on that tackle. Second call at 11. Forcier complete. That'll be a first down for Michigan. And Carlos Brown, the running back, split out that time, knocked out of bounds by Andy Dorsley, but it's a gain of 13 yards.
I made a trip to Michigan 2 springs ago, Rich's first spring here with his football team. They could not hurry up and get to the line in a quick fashion then because they didn't know where to line up. Just seeing the progress from that spring to this point here is impressive.
He said it was the same thing he expected to see at West Virginia, a giant leap from year 1 to year 2. Brown again, this time, just got back to the line of scrimmage, swallowed up by that defensive line.
I don't think people understand, maybe they do, but they don't want to admit it, how difficult it is for a coach to come in with a brand new strategy and philosophy and try to get everybody in the locker room to understand that, and players who weren't recruited for this type of offense. So the building block, the stage, the time it takes, you got to be patient with it.
Well, he is a proven coach with a proven system and a proven recruiter. He will win given time. Shown that over and over. Forcier, good protection. Now he takes off. Stayed behind the line. Throws complete to the sideline, to the goal line. Touchdown. Junior Hemingway got behind the coverage and just sneaked inside the pylon for the score. Looked like Dorsley came up to try to help on the tackle, lost his man.
Yes, he sure did. And, you know, the patience of the quarterback, Forcier, not to tuck it and run, but allow the receiver to get open and to make the double move on there. Excellent poise by young Tate Forcier.
It was Lewis and not Dorsley who made the mistake. And the mistake gives Michigan the opening score. 7-0. We're at the Big House, and they are on their feet.
If you love pop- Popeye's chicken like I do, you're gonna love this little piece of information. For a very limited time, you can get everything you love about my bona fide chicken in my new Louisiana Traveler's Wings. These are bite-sized pieces of bona fide heaven. Nobody, and I mean nobody, slow marinates wings in Louisiana seasonings like I do, and then cooks them up fresh for just $2.99. Or you can get 11 pieces of my chicken for just $9.99. There are no wings like my wings anywhere on this planet. Trust me on this one, honey, because you know I speak the truth.
Louisiana!
Appetizers, gentlemen.
I'll start with the steak tartare.
And you, sir?
I'll have the same. But hold the tartare sauce.
The tartare sauce? Really?
I don't like it.
The more you save on insurance, the more you'll have for football. Drivers who switch their home and auto to Allstate saved an average of $503 a year. Are you in good hands?
Ooh, creamy brulee.
Introducing the all-new Chevy Equinox. With an EPA estimated 32 miles per gallon and up to 600 miles between fill-ups. It's the most fuel-efficient crossover on the highway. Better than the Honda CR-V, Toyota RAV4, and even the Ford Escape Hybrid. The all-new Chevy Equinox.
After being elected president and vice president, where is the first place both Barack Obama and Joe Biden came to be heard on Sunday morning? They came to George.
Folks think I'm cool.
Sundays mean This Week with George on ABC.
College football in high definition is presented by Vizio.
Exactly what Rich Rodriguez wanted to see, a seven-play drive that went 52 yards and resulted in a touchdown. Got the fans into it, got his ball club ahead. Good start for the freshman quarterback, huh?
Absolutely, a great start there. And, you know, now he's going to have to sit on the bench for a few snaps, maybe series, let the other guys audition.
I don't know. He may have passed the audition already.
Well, he would have our smelling test.
West and Winchester are deep again.
Now, Western Michigan, their goal was to come out and to start fast, and they've talked about it. They could not afford to start slow in the Big House. They understand that. Tim Hiller, he's a star player. He's got to pick his offense up now and go.
Block and took it straight up to the 33-yard line. Now to Matt Weiner in our Times Square studio in New York. Matt.
Thanks very much. I'm Matt Weiner, and throughout the game, I'll keep you on top of everything happening across the nation. We begin with this Taco Bell update from Stillwater, Oklahoma. Best preseason ranking ever for the Cowboys, but Georgia marches down the field. Joe Cox to Michael Moore on their opening drive, 7-0.
Georgia's got to replace so many guys off that offensive unit. They're stars, and yet here they are on the road doing it again.
But like Thursday night, I underestimated that SEC again. South Carolina against NC State.
They look
ACC.
Good.
These athletes in the SEC just seem a little bigger and a little faster and a little tougher than the rest of the conferences.
Hiller, first down from the shotgun. Completes the pass to Arnheim. He'll pick up 6 or 7 yards. Who are your impact players on this side of the ball?
Well, Mike, what do you say with defense here on this one here with Michigan? Brandon Graham on the defensive line likes to stay in the backfield. 6 sacks in 08, led his defensive lineman there. His linebacking buddy, Obiat Azay, almost 100 tackles last year. He's a leader. He has to keep them all together. And then Stevie Brown, kind of a hybrid linebacker, strong safety, blitzing today as well as coverage.
West the single setback. He gets the carry. Had some running room if he'd have cut it outside. As it was, he got almost 4 yards before Ryan Van Bergen made the tackle. 6'6 sophomore out of Whitehall, Michigan.
And Mike, when you talk about size, you're talking about an offensive line at Western Michigan. Most of these guys have not missed the chow table one time since they got on campus. 300-plus pound guys. So they're big fellas up front. Michigan's got to use their quickness and get off blocks. But if Western Michigan can get it going on the ground up front and fit on Michigan, they'll push them out of there.
Talking about new schemes, they have a new defensive scheme under Greg Robinson, who replaces Scott Schaefer as the defensive coordinator. West, good effort after he took the initial hit, dove forward with Mike Martin, the nose man, on his back, and picked up the first down.
You know, you mentioned Greg Robinson. That's a great hire and a big pickup for Michigan. Robinson's an excellent football coach, has been around a lot of programs, UCLA and Texas, to mention a few big ones.
And the NFL.
Yeah, NFL. And that experience, his players have bought in immediately. His communication skills with his defenders and the players, they love his enthusiasm.
That was a first down run, so it's second and eight. Hiller, blitz coming. You don't get there. He's got plenty of time. He still has to throw it away. They were able to double cover Nunez downfield.
Now, Tim Hiller is a big object back there. He can throw over folks that are in front of him. Michigan dials up a little bit different pressure. That's more of a blitz type coming off of linemen and back staying in to protect. So only three options for him in the passing game, and they were doubled up in the secondary.
It will be third and eight. Again, watch the slot guy. They love to throw to him, and this time it's Nunez. Blitz coming. Hiller got rid of it, but floats it right down the middle and nearly intercepted by Mike Williams. That ball was just up for grabs as Brandon Graham, their leading sacker, drew a bead on Hiller.
Well, this time here, right tackle, top of your screen here, gets beat. 65, Philip Swanson, that's just speed off the corner. I talked about the big bodies. They don't miss the chow line. They got to get back, though, against those quick defensive linemen from Michigan.
Matthews will drop back to his own 10 this time for Armour's punt. Better kick this time. And Matthews makes the fair catch at the 10. A 45-yard punt and no return for Ben Armour. 7-0 Michigan.
People think that Honda is always the most fuel-efficient choice. Well, the Chevy Cobalt XFE has better highway mileage than a comparable Honda Civic. The Chevy Traverse has better mileage than a Honda Pilot. The all-new Chevy Equinox has better mileage than Honda CR-V, and Chevy Malibu has better mileage than Accord. However, Honda does make something that we just can't compete with. It's self-propelled. There's never been more reasons to look at Chevy.
Whoa! Now I'm the Asawar. Man, it is scorching in here.
Come on in here, man. It feels good.
Look, if you want to be a beast, you gotta stay cool in the heat of the moment. Try this. It's cold. You ready? Let's go.
Nike Pro Hypercool Apparel at Dick's Sporting Goods. Better athlete, better team.
ESPN's College Football on ABC. Brought to you by Cadillac. Dick's Sporting Goods. Every season starts at Dick's. Capital One, what's in your wallet? And Dr. Pepper, drink it slow. Doctor's orders.
Zingerman's Deli up here in Ann Arbor, a landmark. Hey, if they do takeout, it's on me.
Absolutely.
I'm hungry.
Now, I know your old buddy and partner. Don, he would have loved that, right? I've eaten at this place. It's a long line.
Sandwich would have been an appetizer.
A warm-up. The old Blacklitch, he'd have been after that one.
Forcier will stay on for a second series after his success in the opening drive. Brown. Check it. Forcier faked to Brown and kept it.
and was taken down by Mario Armstrong, a strong safety.
Well, in audition one, Tate Forcier, he had the stage early on, very impressive in making the right decisions with the football. The composure here, not getting flustered on the corner and buying time for the touchdown pass. A very strong start by Forcier, a true freshman.
Denard Robinson is on the field. He's the sensational other freshman quarterback. They had him in a slot. They give it to him. This guy with incredible speed. The running back coach, Fred Jackson, said he has never seen a kid any faster than he is, and he's seen some good ones.
Yeah, he's seen some fast ones out there, and you know, what I like seeing there is that Rich Rodriguez is trying to put his players on the field. You know, I like that. Don't have somebody that can fly sitting over there drinking water during the day.
That's right. Third down and long. This time, however, Forcier takes off, hit a couple of times, and take it down at the 15. A good defensive stand that time by the Broncos as Deontay LeGreer, the middle linebacker, closed on him and made the stop. He's a redshirt freshman out of Rochelle, Georgia.
You know, a little bit of that series there, you can't hold against Nick Sheridan, the quarterback. You know, they tried to put in Calvin McGee and Rich, tried to go with Denard Robinson, bringing him around, getting a little cute, getting off base maybe from what the first series was.
Arnheim and West, a two-deep punt return unit. Beautiful high kick. And because of that, West had no chance. Swallowed up by special teams after a gain of one. And a 47-yard boomer from Zoltan Mesko. A Ray Guy semifinalist a year ago. And one of the guys contending for the same honor this season.
Hey, Mom, I need some minutes.
I just gave you some at the restaurant.
Yeah, no, I threw them out. They were old.
Old?
So.
They're rollover minutes. They are as good as new. You know, not everyone gets to keep their unused minutes. And these days, we can't afford to be wasteful. Saving minutes.
Saves money. Yeah.
Only AT&T's Family Talk with rollover saves your family's unused minutes. And saving minutes saves money. For back to school, get the LG Neon for $29.99 after mail-in rebate.
This Labor Day, come into any Chick-fil-A from 10:30 a.m. to close wearing your favorite sports team logo and get a free chicken sandwich.
On September 15, bring home the first summer blockbuster of the year.
That's cool.
With new origins and new revelations never seen before. X-Men Origins Wolverine, September 15.
No way to hide it. If you drive drunk, we will find you. Cops everywhere are stepping up enforcement and cracking down like never before.
Sir, have you been drinking tonight? Sir, have you been drinking this evening?
Sir, have you been drinking tonight?
Make no mistake. You will get caught and you will be arrested. Over the limit, under arrest.
Garth, you're up.
Hold on, I'm at CapitalOne.com picking a photo for my credit card. Here's one from my prom. Oh, what memories.
How about one from our golf outing?
I know, maybe one of my firstborn son.
Dad, Mom says the boys gotta go.
Personalize your card by uploading your own photo at CapitalOne.com.
What's in your wallet?
Kelsey Grammer stars in Hank. Wednesday, September 30th on ABC.
7-0 Michigan midway through the first quarter. Tonight on ABC, top 10 powerhouses, number 5 Alabama and number 7 Virginia Tech collide in the Chick-fil-A kickoff game presented by Southwest Airlines. The Chick-fil-A kickoff game, part of Dick's Sporting Goods kickoff week, tonight at 8 Eastern on ABC.
Couple of defensive stalwarts out there tonight.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Virginia Tech's wide receivers better show up and get down the field.
Alabama defense, terrific a year ago. Should be better this year. Hiller in the shotgun. Going to rush the last couple of plays. Good protection this time. Overthrows Nunez, who was beautifully covered by Donovan Warren, who is the steadying force in the secondary, according to Greg Robinson.
Now, Bill Cubitt, they're the head coach. They come into a ball game and they script their first 15. They do a lot of different formations. And so you're handcuffed a little bit, in my opinion, offensively when you do that. I understand the strategy and theory, what Cuba's trying to accomplish. But I also look at this, and I look at a stagnant offense right now. You need to dial something up. You better get aggressive, or else Michigan's offense is going to make it 14-0 before you know what's going on.
This is their Wildcat formation. West, the running back, takes the direct snap. Then he takes off, and West almost broke it as it was. He picked up nearly 7 yards off the right side. Aaron Winchester got him a good block, as did Matt Stevens, number 84, the tight end.
There's the dialing I'm talking about. Get to the Wildcat formation. You've got to be aggressive. You've got to give a different look. You've got to change it up against Michigan. I love when you put the ball in the hands of West and something unique like that, especially when you have the blockers out front.
Of course, you want every play to work, but the other thing you're doing is trying to see how Michigan counters your offensive formations. Hiller is back in there and under center. Short set, throws too high for Nunez. Had him open, but threw the ball over the top of his shoulders. And Donovan Warren was there to make sure he couldn't come down with it.
You know what? And I said earlier, our impact players, that Nunez was one of those guys that had to be a go-to guy when the ball came to him, make a play. This is a catchable football. Nunez has got to be driving with his legs and not stopping them. You see how he leaned, Mike? That's giving up your body there. You're having to lean then to catch the ball.
They lost their top two wide receivers from a year ago. Nunez was the third guy with 57 catches. They're really counting on him this season. Armour to punt for the third time in this game. High floater. Fair catch made at the 15-yard line. Let's get out on the sideline. Quint Kessinger. Quint?
Mike, what's been most impressive from field level about Tate Forcier? Confidence, poise, swagger. He's a good athlete. He lacks the height, obviously. Reminds me kind of like a Chase Daniel-type player, but Tate obviously a better athlete than Chase Daniel. Maybe you could compare him to a young Jeff Garcia. Enrolled in January, got a head start in terms of learning this system and stole the show in the spring game.
Hardly looks like a true freshman, does he? Forcier fakes it to Brown. Will keep it himself. He is more quick than fast, but he's fast enough.
How about that? That play is designed right there. When he gets on the corner, the quarterback has to beat his one man. And we've heard so much about Denard Robinson's speed as a quarterback. Well, the freshman Forcier, he can run as well. Like you say, maybe not as fast as he is quick, but great footwork and ability to make somebody miss. This guy missing open space.
He's, as far as speed is concerned, he's right in the middle between Sheridan and Robinson. He is probably a more accomplished overall quarterback, maybe a more dangerous quarterback. And there's a flag down on this play. Justin Braska makes the tackle. And it will go against Michigan. Forcier out of San Diego threw for 61 touchdowns in his high school career, ran for 24. He's a good athlete, also played corner and free safety. There are the numbers for his career.
Number 50, 10-yard penalty, replay second down.
And his brother Jason was a former quarterback for Michigan who transferred to Stanford, actually tried to come back this year, but his eligibility was questioned and he wasn't able to do it, or you would have had brothers on this ball club at quarterback. Penalty will back Michigan up. And the screen they tried to set up, it's an incomplete pass. It went right through the hands of Kelvin Grady, who was on the basketball team for 2 years, often came out to watch his brother play at practice, and often joked with Rich Rodriguez about playing football. Well, he quit the basketball team, and now he is playing football, but he dropped that one on right through his hands.
Different kind of ball to catch, and you're not used to running to the quarterback, and the speed of the ball is a little faster than normal, so that's just an adjustment that a basketball guy needs to make to the football field.
Well, bouncing this one is not a good idea.
No. That'll get you a little seat time.
Yeah, that's right. Four-man rush, excellent protection. Forcier hangs in the pocket. Down the middle and over through Martell Webb, the tight end by one stride. Whoa, what a big guy. 6'4", 245, lumbering down the middle of the field.
You know, Carlos Brown in the backfield, he's helping out his quarterback. This is a great job of blocking. Watch this down. You're talking about stepping up and delivering a message. Boom. That's a flip. That buys the quarterback time to throw it down the field. Likes that as a running back.
And the next time, that rusher's not going to be quite as aggressive, is it? Oh. West will let this one go as it runs out of bounds near the 40-yard line. And Western Michigan, after that opening drive by Michigan, has settled down a little bit. And another good kick, this one 44 yards.
Yeah, you mentioned that settling down. Sometimes a young football team comes out, early success, they lose that little focus and that sharpness of paying attention to detail, and that's part of the growth that a football team has to go through.
And if you're Western Michigan, you're coming in here in front of 106,000 people, so the nerves are the butterflies are flying in formation at the beginning of this.
Absolutely. I know they're getting towards the end now of their scripted plays here, and it'll be interesting to see once they get through that what they dial up after that. Now
Hiller has been off early, which is unusual for him. This one he dumps to West. Little check down, and West is out across the 47-yard line.
That's 13 plays out of a 15-play scripted format, so they're getting into it now. We'll start seeing things. I really like when they get the ball in the hands of Brandon West, the Wildcat formation, but he seems to be one of those kind of players that can make Michigan, make him miss.
I think so, too. Had over 1,000 yards rushing a year ago and also caught 38 passes, so he is a very experienced running back. Arnheim is drilled as soon as the ball got there. It was incomplete. No wonder they like Donovan Warren, number 6, in the corner. This kid has shown us something early. He can cover and he can stick.
I like the way Warren drove through the receiver. Robert Arnheim is a converted quarterback, and he put the ball out there, and the drive with that helmet right into the chest on the ball. Great form tackle.
Michigan defense has acquitted itself very well so far. Empty backfield for Hiller. Three-man rush, and I don't think they got the snap in time. Hiller was trying
by the offense, 5-yard penalty, still third down.
Hiller was trying to get his center to get that ball back to him in a hurry, and not quite.
And you know what? This is Greg Robinson, defensive coordinator, had a call on at the right time. The lineman dropped out of there, fire zone, if you will. And it changed the thought process of Hiller. You'll see just at the end there, right before the snap count, you'll see Michigan jump out of there. And that took Hiller off his cadence call and caused the delay of game.
Again, three-man rush. Hiller with plenty of time. Throws incomplete. Now it's intercepted. Picked off by Floyd Simmons on the deflection. Went right to him. And Simmons with a return of 12. Michigan has the ball in Bronco territory.
Some of the credit has to go to the Michigan defense, but a lot of it has to go against what Western Michigan's offense is doing or not doing. Juan Nunez, number 81, and these receivers are letting Hiller down. The ball is delivered on the outside. Nunez just doesn't come up with the reception. He's got to keep moving his feet, stay with the ball. And good again for Michigan's defense for coming up with a conversion. But Western Michigan just looks cautious at the receiver position.
That was Sissoko. And now Denard Robinson is in at quarterback. The heralded freshman out of Deerfield Beach,
down.
Florida.
Both on offense, number 71. 5-yard penalty. Still first down.
He has been here just 3.5 weeks. Rich Rodriguez said he is just too good to redshirt. He's got to be able to play.
Please reset the game clock to 4:07, please. 4:07.
ESPN.com had him in the top 10 a year ago. Just a great athlete. His nickname is Shoelace. And Quinn Kesenich will have more on that in a second. Fascinating story. Fumbles the snap, takes off. Broken plays are very dangerous for a kid like this. Look at that speed. See ya. Did I say broken plays were dangerous? 43 yards. Might as well have been 143. Once he got a step, it was over.
I'm still trying to find his shoelaces.
How's that for a debut? Denard Robinson. Well, Fred Jackson, the running back coach, said, I've never seen a kid that fast.
You know what? You can't coach speed. Denard Robinson, when he drops the ball on the ground and picks it up, this is just explosion. Terrell Pryor at Ohio State. Things, guys like this, they got it. There's nothing you can do about it. And as a defender, if you don't keep your feet and drive through and run with him, you'll never tackle the feet or the legs of Denard Robinson. Certainly, that right there just put a lot of pressure on the quarterback spot in the rotation, right?
It did.
You know what?
Audition passed. 4.32 is his best time in the 40. He sure looked faster than that on that 43-yard run.
When you look at the big picture, though, Western Michigan right now, looking in the mirror themselves, it's lack of execution. When you don't catch the ball on third and five for conversions and first down, balls like this turn around, and the coach has the confidence across the field to put a true freshman in because of field position, and the next thing you know, it's 7 points.
Weston Winchester deep again. Great start for the Wolverines. West from the four. Finds the seam again up to the 27. Quint, why do they call him Shoelace?
Rec League. He's a 7-year-old rec league football player. Denard Robinson didn't tie his shoes. We'll show you how he does it. He pulls the laces down and then brings the Velcro on top. Laces untied, but the Velcro is the key. That keeps his lightning quick feet in these shoes, but there's the nickname, Shoelace, untied for 7.
Said the only time he ties those shoelaces is when he wears his good shoes and goes to church on Sunday. Now, Western Michigan has to feel a little pressure right here. They'd love to get something started. Winchester will pick up about 4 before Obi Azay, the middle linebacker, a very good player and a very intelligent, well-spoken young man.
Hey, pay off these shoelaces, though, before we leave that concept.
Sure.
I've got a feeling that by the time he plays Ohio State, somebody's going to hit him in the Big Ten, and he's got to tighten those shoelaces up. This isn't Pee Wee football anymore.
Well, based on that first run, he can do anything with his shoelaces he wants to, as far as I'm concerned. He can play barefoot. Draw play, West. Boy, Michigan was all over that one. It'd be a loss of about 4 yards. And this young Michigan defense that was pounded a year ago gave up more points than any Michigan defense ever. It's looking pretty sharp here.
You know what they are? Game. Mike, can't you just see the speed and the quickness of that Michigan defensive line against those big bodies? And if it's not happening fast and quick, you're going to get beat up front.
The rankings were awful a year ago. 84th in the country in scoring defense. That was the big one. They were 10th in the Big Ten in pass defense. Nothing worked. Hence the change in defensive coordinators. 3-9 a year ago. People are already forgetting about it. Hiller hit as he threw. And it was Brandon Graham again. 10 sacks a year ago. 19 in his career. Almost got number 20 right there.
You know, Brandon Graham, like you say, last year he liked to play in the backfield. He's starting off again. He's one of the players who said, we are all for this coach. You've got three rushers against five blockers. Unacceptable. Unacceptable for the offensive formation to not block and protect with three-man rush.
Hiller has hit only one of his last eight because of Michigan's defense. Matthews again forced to make the fair catch off the foot of Ben Armour. Another good kick, 41 yards and no return. Forcier snapping that chin strap. Well, they used to be the old saying, if you have two quarterbacks, you really don't have one. If you got three, what do you have? A 10-1 season, maybe?
You've got an audition, as we've been calling it.
Rich Rodriguez says it's all about competition. Denard Robinson will come in and takes the direct snap and takes off. If you have followed Rich Rodriguez, he was at West Virginia before, and if this young man reminds you a little bit about an early Pat White, it's probably a good comparison. Pat White was not the greatest thrower when he started, but boy, he was an electric runner just like this kid.
After seeing that touchdown run there, I mean, the comparisons will obviously pick up now.
Well, we know he's got a strong arm. That thing was a rifle and somehow caught by Kelvin Grady out of Grand Rapids.
It certainly helps that you're at home and you're up 14-0 and you're in the game. So that, you know, the pressure's off. This is a great breeding ground, a grooming ground for a young quarterback. But to be able to throw the football and deliver it on target to the right guy, very impressive.
Boy, I was impressed by Grady's ability to catch that ball. He was only about 10 yards away from the quarterback who threw him a bullet. Throws him another bullet, and this time nobody was ready for it. It was Hemingway, who was still looking downfield as if he were going to throw a block. And that ball whistled by him, never even saw it.
Remember what we said early in the broadcast, that the quarterbacks that in this offense here have to be able to make a lot of calls and decisions and get it to the right people. And that's going to be a part of the auditioning, the analysis of these quarterbacks that Rich Rod will go through and trying to determine who the best guy is.
Fake the reverse. Robinson this time dragged down as he got across midfield by a yard. One of the third and about four. Vernon Stewart made a tackle. Well, Michigan has certainly dominated this game so far. Not as much as you might expect in time of possession, but look at the yards, 131-29, and the scoreboard 14-0. Robinson. And you see how quick he takes off. I think, as you might expect, he's a lot more comfortable running the ball than he is throwing.
Yeah, the quarterback draw, too. He has to be a little bit more patient.
Yes.
And that just comes with it. You know, at this point here, Tate Forcier has more composure about the game, right? I mean, Denard Robinson's gotten away with a big play because of his speed, but has not been as patient as Forcier.
More refined, perhaps, because he had all that spring work, and Forcier comes into the ball game, and Michigan says, we're going to go for it. Need a yard and a half for a first down. And we've got a timeout. I check it, that's the end of the quarter. And a good one for Michigan. 14-0 over Western Michigan in front of a sellout crowd. Michigan still has its offense on the field for fourth and a long one. The punting unit is not out there. The Wolverines are up 14-0. They led the Big Ten with 14 out of 20 fourth down gambles a year ago. Car Brown, the tailback, first down and more. That shows confidence not only your offense, but on your defense if you're going to do that at midfield.
The little subtle things that a coach can do to send a message to his football team, I really like it. He's 14-0. Western Michigan's offense doing nothing. His defense is playing well. Minimal risk for the upside that you got in that play right there.
We have seen Forcier, we have seen Robinson. Both have been impressive. Forcier with a keeper. Reaches the Western Michigan 36-yard line. Freddie Bishop makes the stop there.
One of the things that I always am mindful of watching Rich Rodriguez's offense is that defenses have to play every snap with discipline. I remember all the years that we've seen a Pat White take off because nothing, boom, there he goes.
Makes you defend the entire field. That's the tight end, Kevin Coker. They are very hopeful he'll have a big year. Only 6 catches last season. And Austin Pritchard is probably the best defender on this Bronco defense. All-conference a year ago, makes the stop, but it is a first down for the Wolverines.
And in the early years of this offense at West Virginia, they had Owen Schmidt, that fullback, and he could do so many things, and it really spread the field. So if you get a tight end here at Michigan that can get it going, a real bonus.
Brown dancing his way down to the 20-yard line.
Big emphasis made about the development and the progress when the Coach Rodriguez offense goes to year two. Look what happened at West Virginia. I mean, obviously the record improved tremendously, but man, the points scored. Absolutely a huge difference, points and yards per game. It's a marked difference. You have to understand it. You have to go through it. You can't just look at it on the board and learn it.
While you're learning it, you play very slowly. And this is an offense that doesn't work if you play very slowly. Kelvin Grady, the former basketball player, on the end around inside the 10-yard line. Well, Grady, what a find he has been. I mean, right now he is fourth on the depth chart as a slot receiver. But the more he plays in practice, the more he moves up on the depth chart. Right now he's seeing a lot of action. Just got a scholarship this week. Brown. Not much this time. Justin Braska, good defensive end, makes the tackle. But Michigan is dominating this game.
And you know, the Western Michigan's defensive coordinator, Steve Morrison, who played here at Michigan, they've been sitting back and being pretty plain and vanilla in what they've done over there. It's time now to dial it up. They got to change it up. They have to make a play, cause a fumble, do something different.
Two tight ends, two wide receivers. Brown is the single setback. Forcier the quarterback. And Forcier wants to throw. On the roll for the end zone, wide open touchdown. The tight end, Kevin Coker. How do you get lost at 6'4", 249? You can feel the memories of last year slipping away.
Isn't it amazing what success does?
Yes, it is. And this is success. A brand new quarterback to a big tight end. 21-0. Welcome back to the big house at Michigan, where 106,000 fans pretty happy right now as their Wolverines are stomping Western Michigan 21-0 second quarter.
You know, with all the controversy this week surrounding Michigan, I mean, don't you get the feeling I did walking around that the fans were just glad to be back at a game and they're excited to be back seeing a successful football team?
Anything but read a newspaper.
Yeah, I really do. That's not what college football is all about, controversy. And Michigan, as great as this institution is, they're enjoying and appreciating what they're seeing today.
Go going to be a great sense of relief for the coaching staff and the players just to get back on this field and to have this kind of success. Weston Winchester deep for the fourth time for a kickoff. West stumbles out to the 30-yard line.
One of the things that the trademark so far has been for me is the patience and the understanding of Tate Forcier and how he allows the plays to develop. We saw it in the opening series and when he went down for the touchdown pass. And just seeing the play evolve, understanding where players are coming from. The defense, they cover one, two, three's coming backside, let it happen and develop. So a lot of patience and understanding right now from Tate Forcier.
Western Michigan's offense, five drives, four three and outs. Michigan, having suffered through the last two home openers, doing much, much better today. And that will take them out to about the 37-yard line. There is a flag down on the play, however, as West lowers his head and got as much out of it as he could. Good run will come back for the Broncos. Well, if you're Western Michigan,
illegal formation by the offense, more than four men in the backfield, 5-yard penalty, replay, first down.
You got a veteran offense, a quarterback who's projected to go in the top two, three, four rounds of next year's NFL draft, and nothing's worked so far. What do you do?
Well, and that's what, you know, the audience really needs to understand and appreciate is this is a good football team. Last year had a very successful run, went to a bowl game. They have an outstanding quarterback. I think right now they're overwhelmed by a very inspired defense and an offense that's executing.
Hiller lost it, dives on it back at the 9-yard line. Wanted to throw a bubble screen and couldn't do it. Now to Matt Weiner in our Times Square studio in New York for a Sports Center right now. Matt.
All right, Mike, and a couple of big time escapes from the Big Ten. Navy's first trip to Ohio Stadium since 1931 came down to a 2-point conversion that was picked off by Brian Roll and returned for two. Number six Ohio State escapes against the Middies. Meanwhile, 22nd ranked Iowa needed to block a pair of field goals in the final seconds to hold on against Northern Iowa today.
Well, that's remarkable there, particularly Navy at Ohio State. Who would have thought
it looked great? It just looked, really looked good.
Coming on the way. Completes the short pass, but Bubakar Sissoko drilled Juan Nunez. He made him pay the price for catching that ball.
You know, at some point, Western Michigan, a good football team that has high aspirations for this season, they're going to have to become more aggressive with maybe it's play calling, the tempo, getting in and out of the huddle.
Yeah.
But they got to change the pace up. Right now, everything is being dictated by Michigan.
They certainly have been very tentative on offense. Third and a mile. Flanker screen, Nunez. Boy, Michigan had just snipped everything out. Obiezze, the middle linebacker, caught up with that screen and wouldn't let it develop.
A lot of the success here on this defense has to be given now to Greg Robinson, the defensive coordinator. And we heard the players and Rich Rod talk about communication and the players saying how that Greg Robinson teaches all of us to understand what everybody else's role is. And you can see the communication taking place out there.
What was funny is when they said, well, we can ask him why. That's a question you don't usually ask a football coach. Is not, you know, why, coach? They're going to say, you do it.
Yeah.
But Greg Robinson will explain it to him. Matthews trying to get something going on the return, slips a couple of tackles, belted down at the 43. 15-yard return after a 43-yard punt, and Michigan back in Western Michigan territory. 9:53 to go in the half.
ESPN's College Football on ABC, brought to you by Aflac. We've got you under our wing. Under Armour. Experience Under Armour's fastest generation of cleats. And Verizon Wireless.
Students are back on campus here at Ann Arbor, and as many as can be packed into this 106,000 seat stadium are here, and they've had a great time so far. 21-0 over Western Michigan. As we told you at the beginning of the broadcast, it has been a tumultuous week based on interviews with six players. The Detroit Free Press wrote a major article that said Michigan broke the rules with required offseason work exceeding NCAA mandated limits in the offseason, as well as the prelude to the start of the season, at least 9 hours on Sundays after games last year. That surpasses the mandated four-hour limit, that they exceeded the weekly supervised limit of 20 hours a week. Rich Rodriguez said, we know the rules. We didn't break the rules. We've never broken the rules before, and we're not going to. There is an investigation ongoing by Michigan and the Big Ten, and they have an outside consultant as well to come in and discuss this situation. I just don't get the feeling that anybody at Michigan is really concerned that they're going to find anything. I think they think this is a bunch of disgruntled players.
I think it's a witch hunt. You know what? I think you've got some disgruntled players, as you're saying there, and you've got a situation where somebody's given legs to the accusations. All college football players have a lot of requirements of them. They all are competitive. They all work hard. They spend lots of time in the weight room and studying film on their own. And you know, this is an issue not just for Michigan, but for everybody.
Robinson comes in and throws a pass on the run and completes it to Laterial Savoy. The thing is, the rules, all those numbers, 20 hours a week, those are supervised by coaches. Anything unsupervised on the, that the players do on their own doesn't count toward any of those limits, and there's a lot of confusion about that.
There's a lot of gray area too. You know, like you're stretching on the field before practice, that doesn't count against the clock. I mean, little things like that. You've got to have a spirit of integrity by the coaching staffs. I mean, for them to prove this is going to be really hard. Unless these one of these six players has gone and actually taken notes and documented that they were out there working per the instruction and supervision of these coaches, unless they have documents, it's going to be really hard to prove it.
I think the other thing you have to keep in mind is when a new coach comes in and changes the system as drastically as Rich Rodriguez did, some young men's dreams are going to be shattered. They are never going to play in his system. And that leads to some people who are frankly quite upset about their situation. If you have 100 kids, finding six of them who are unhappy is not a stretch. This is not to say that there is nothing to their allegations. That's going to have to play out in the investigation. It's just the feeling that I think you get as well as I do.
You know what, and you're so true and accurate on that. There are very few players in a program really happy. You know, and everybody wants to be playing. Everybody's mom and dad doesn't understand what's going on out
there.
But you have to understand, too, that these players are spending so much time on their own trying to get better.
Holding by the offense, number 50, 10-yard penalty, still second down.
And you know, change is tough. There's a reason they brought a new football coach in at Michigan. They were looking for something different from Lloyd Carr. So Rich Rodriguez, when you hired the man, you knew that you were hiring a tenacious person, right? I mean, it's not rocket science. This guy has a history. He's a competitive human being. That's why you wanted him at Michigan. So I think you have to be patient. Back in 1969, apparently, Dan Dierdorf and a bunch of those guys, when they brought in Bo Schembechler, you know, it was tough then, too. Well, you know what? That kind of worked out as well.
Yeah, it worked out all right, didn't it? Forcier throws on the run, complete to the sideline, to the 29-yard line. Good throw by Tate Forcier on the run. Really impressed by this kid who plays, really seems to play within himself.
And you know what I'm impressed with is a lot of the publications and all the print and the reports are that Denard Robinson, his competitor, is fast and this and that, but he's kept his head about him, and Forcier has gone out and done what he can do. I love the management of the game right now by Forcier.
And now they're going to say that was incomplete. Michael Shaw out of the backfield couldn't hold it at the sideline. And this play may be under review.
Field, the previous play is under further review.
Shaw is out of Trotwood, Ohio, a 6-foot sophomore.
who carried the ball 42 times a year ago, getting a chance to go out as a pass receiver on this. The other thing about those limits is if you are given an hour of supervised lifting per day, as we see the throw on the replay, and tough to tell from that angle. If you only lift weights the prescribed number of hours that you are on, are being supervised, you're not going to get any better. You have to go over there three or four times as much as the supervised hours to get better. And you know, you were a great football player. You had to do so many things beyond what you were required to do to get better.
Above and beyond.
Sure.
Above and beyond. And of course, nobody wants to give free rein to these coaches to where they're going to rule all of the time.
No.
The student athletes.
Those
the
would be 80-hour weeks.
Absolutely. It'd be all over with. It would be all over with but the crying.
The ruling on the field is confirmed. Third down.
That would be incomplete.
But, you know, I thought Jim Tressel this week of Ohio State stepped up and showed a lot of class and integrity.
Wasn't that nice?
And rational comment when he says, you know what, everybody's out here working hard. These kids, you can't keep them out of the place. We have to lock the doors and tell them to stay away.
An Ohio State coach supporting an embattled Michigan coach. How about that?
Yeah.
It's sportsmanship week, isn't
amen.
It?
Amen. Now, that's sportsmanship.
Yes, it is. Forcier, quarterback draw. Dives to the 26-yard line. Kid is very impressive, a young man out of San Diego.
Absolutely. Man, you see that, Mike. You know what? A lot of freshmen, young, early runners would have been looking for the carpet. Head down, journey's over. He picks up four more as he cuts back into the middle of the field.
Well, this is a question mark here for Olus Navich because he's never kicked in a ball game. Brian Wright is the other place kicker. Neither has he. And Michigan wants to see if these guys are game ready. And the answer is yes. That's a 44-yarder with plenty of leg from Jason Olus Navich. All the signs positive so far for the Wolverines, and they are rolling. 24-0 at home. Michigan rolling in the first half over Western Michigan, 24-0. The NASCAR Sprint Cup Series heads back south for the Labor Day weekend. Two races left for Kyle Busch, Casey Kane, and Mark Martin to get off the bubble and into the chase. The NASCAR Sprint Cup Series at Atlanta. Coverage starts tomorrow night at 7 Eastern on ESPN with NASCAR Countdown. The telecast presented by Pennzoil. For more information, log on to ESPN.com. I like the night racing.
Yeah, it's good. Reminds me of being at home on our own on the tollway. It just seems more real.
Reminds me of being in the back roads of West Virginia at night with no lights on.
Oh, jeez.
Right to kick, West and Winchester deep again. West dives out to the 26-yard line. Let's go down to the sideline. Quint, what do you have?
Mike, I spoke with Michigan Athletic Director Bill Martin at length before kickoff today. I asked him what was most surprising about this week's events, and he kind of echoed what you said earlier. He said it was shocking that the arch enemies have come out in support of this Michigan program. He also went on to tell me about the massive amounts of email that he has received from alums, from boosters, from fans, and 95% of the email that he has received have been in support of Coach Rich Rodriguez and the staff. He went on to say that the reason they hired an outside investigative firm was to make sure that there was total independence and neutrality in the investigation. The last thing I asked him was about a timetable because the folks here at Michigan want to get this issue out of the way before the end of football season, obviously. He said, really, they want it done ASAP, but that remains to be seen how quickly the NCAA can process this whole issue.
Quint, I think there was another telling sign as well. He did not have a good departure, Rich Rodriguez, from West Virginia. But there hasn't been a soul there who said, you know, he did this here. He violated rules, and that's one of the reasons we parted company. That hasn't happened. His former players have supported him, and if there was a lot to it, you would think some of those guys would have stepped up and say, hey, there's something wrong.
Well, and in our world of journalism here, there, you know, the question of allegations and anonymous sources comes into play. You know,
sure,
the integrity of the accusation and of the accusers. You know, you give legs to something like that, and it stains the perceived reputation of an entire university.
Hiller has been under pressure the entire game. Now he faces third down. Michigan shows blitz. He throws incomplete. It was nearly intercepted. Obi Ezeay putting pressure on Troy Wolfolk. Had the ball come right down in his hands as Obi Ezeay shot the gap and had a free run.
Watch
Tim Hiller.
You know, Mike, watch all the changes and how they come different at you from Michigan. You get a fire zone middle of the field. Linebacker comes, replaces different bodies from Greg Robinson's defense moving around. But Tim Hiller has no clue, and he's a smart quarterback. He has no clue what's in front of him.
Matthews deep again. Armory's had a really good day punting. This one not as high and as returnable. And Matthews will only get about three, and there is a flag down as well as he reaches the 27-yard line after Armour's 44-yard kick. Tom Harrington down on special teams for Northern Iowa.
During the return, illegal block in the back by the return team, number 12, 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. First down, Michigan.
I think you can look at what has already happened in this ballgame and say this is a Michigan team that does not even resemble last year's Michigan team. And they are up 24-0. Welcome back. Let's take a look at our Pacific Life game summary. Boy, and it is all Michigan. Tate Forcier got it started on the first drive. His pass to Hemingway. Nice little touch throw. Then we saw Denard Robinson, shoelace, pick him up and put him down for 43. Then Forcier again to his tight end, Kevin Coger. A field goal added to that makes it 24-0. And Michigan will get started again with 6:27 to go in the half from its own 20-yard line. Forcier, the quarterback. Carlos Brown, the running back. Brandon Miner, who was listed as the starting tailback, has not played today because of a sprained ankle. They are hopeful that he will be ready next week when they play Notre Dame.
It looks like Rich Rod has decided that Tate Forcier with the hot hand is going to get a lot of these snaps, because it sounded like in our meetings that it was going to be every other series march along rotating quarterbacks.
Haven't seen Nick Sheridan yet, who was the veteran of this group, a junior who had four starts a year ago and played in 10 ball games. But he also said to you, if somebody gets the hot hand, they're playing.
Absolutely.
And Forcier really looked good. Completes this pass to Greg Matthews, taken out of bounds by Dorsley.
You know, he continues to impress with his vision, with his command and his leadership. Just watch this right here. You'll see Western Michigan take the deep ball away. The corner drops deep and opens up the out ball underneath. Don't force the ball. Take what the defense gives you.
And how great is it for Michigan that this young kid is seeing what they're giving him, and he's taking it every time. Great decision maker, Carlos Brown up the middle. And Matthews very slow getting up. You see the senior wide receiver there coming off the field a little slowly.
You know, another real beneficiary to this success of the quarterback Forcier is that offensive line. I mean, you don't have an indecisive quarterback back there running around wondering where to put the ball. He's coming back, planting his foot, letting go of it, and the offensive line looks good.
Absolutely. And this is an offensive line that is much smaller than it was a year ago. And that's LeGreer, the middle linebacker, the freshman, who came in and got the tackle on Forcier as he was running the option and then looking to throw. If you want to run this offense, if you want to run up tempo, you cannot have all those 350-pound guys. They've got to be a lot quicker.
Yeah, you do. And hats off to Western Michigan there for being a little more aggressive into the point of attack, not being indecisive. And Western Michigan's looked terrible today, but they're a good team. They have the potential to compete and contend for the MAC title.
Which is really good news for Michigan fans. Screen set up, Hemingway got a couple of blocks. Midfield down to the 48-yard line. David Mulk, the center who started last year, is a very good ball player, got out and threw him a good block. In fact, at this offensive line, there's only one guy that tips the scales at more than 300 pounds, and that's the left guard. He's only 304.
And if you watch Mock, and when he gets out there, I think he gets two blocks. Here he comes, 50, hits the ground. There's one. He jumps up, comes over, and finds somebody. I mean,
how good is that?
Outstanding effort. But, you know, if you're a 305-pounder in the old system, maybe you can't do that.
That's
right. If you're 280, maybe you get up and have a little athleticism.
That's a great point. And you just love to see that kind of hustle. Well, you made the point at the beginning of our telecast. When we talk to some of these kids, you just got the feeling that, one, they couldn't wait for the game to start, and two, that they were really behind each other and really behind Rich Rodriguez, and that's a great sign for Michigan.
Not only did we have full confirmation of it, there was zero doubt in our mind if these players were behind Rich Rodriguez. I mean, they came out and they talked about it. They had a glow in their eye and their face when they said it to us that we want him to be successful. You know, there was no doubt about the player.
No, it wasn't that tentative, boy, we're really in for this, you know.
No, not at all. And Greg Robinson, when he spoke about Rich Rod, I mean, you can almost see a mist in his eye of,
yeah,
hey, I understand, I feel for you. You know, tough deal being a head coach sometimes.
Forcier. And that one is overthrown. It looked like his receiver was cut off the sideline. Well, it has been a tough week for Rich Rodriguez in the weight of allegations about NCAA violations. He talked to us yesterday about how he's managing all of this.
All the current and former players and the current and former players' parents have been, and my colleagues, coaches throughout the country have called, have been really terrific and calling not just myself but our staff and giving us support and telling us that they believe in us and what we're doing, and it's really helped a tough week go by a lot better.
4CA. And LeGreer makes another tackle.
Yeah, they won't have time to rest on their laurels here. Notre Dame comes in, right?
That's right.
So they'll have some confidence, but the energy level will be a lot better, and more than likely, at least one of the issues dealing with Michigan of whether or not they have a quarterback, that's not going to be a big question this week.
And Charlie Weiss, of course, has not had the easiest of times in the last couple of years at Notre Dame. LeGreer, by the way, already has five tackles in this first half. That's pretty good for a redshirt freshman middle linebacker. Touchdown! Junior Hemingway behind the secondary, 44 yards. Beat David Lewis by a step and a half. What a perfect throw by Forcier. Hemingway now with two touchdowns and 91 yards receiving. Aulus Navich for the point after. How about this? Michigan 31, Western Michigan nothing.
Boy, Hemingway, when he put that foot in the ground, going to the inside just for a brief moment and turned the defensive back's hips, it was over with. And Forcier understood right from the get-go that he had a one-on-one matchup on top. He was waiting for the route to develop, again being patient, letting it happen, protection up front, outstanding execution.
Forcier enrolled in January, went through the entire spring practice. He got a break when Nick Sheridan was injured, so he got all the reps, got to learn this offense,
And obviously, he's a good student of this offense because he has been almost perfect today. 160 yards in total offense for him in the first half.
Now, you know what they're doing here is they're gonna all of those Michigan fans who were thinking, oh boy, here we go with a 4-8 year. The numbers have turned, haven't they?
Haven't they?
Expectations are right back to where they used to be.
Yeah. Which is a challenge in itself.
Yes.
With a pretty darn good debut. And the best kickoff of the day will bounce out of the end zone. Now for today's Aflac trivia question. Michigan had lost two straight home openers. When was the last time they lost three straight? Tough question. You don't think about them losing three straight anytime, let alone home openers.
When we were in a meeting last night, I said never. I just wouldn't have thought
that would have been my answer. Of course, I haven't gotten one right forever.
All right, Western Michigan, get something going for yourselves here. Tim Hiller's got to have some success.
Michigan is really confused and defensively. And they have been everywhere, shown an awful lot of speed. Stevie Brown switched from safety to linebacker all over Glennis Thompson.
I tell you what's happening now at Michigan is the tempo of the offense that's been going on now for a year has forced the defense to learn to play faster and play smarter and to play in open space. Greg Robinson comes in, tweaks the guys, moves them around, motivates them, gets them communicating. You can see the results.
Western Michigan's numbers have just been awful against this defense. And they are going to have to work on the clock because it did not start on that play with 3:17 to go in the first half. Mike Patrick, Craig James, Quint Kesenich, our entire ABC crew, glad you could join us today from Michigan, where the second year of the Rich Rodriguez era has certainly got off to a better start than the first one. Listen to these fans.
We set the game clock to 3 minutes, 2 seconds, to 3:02. We'll start the game clock on my signal.
What a difference the year makes.
I tell you, another guy, you know, we've been mentioning Greg Robinson. How about that guy going from getting whipped every Saturday at 6?
At Syracuse.
You think he's not glad to be on the cheers side?
Absolutely. Hiller is a very smart guy changing the play. And they'll blow it dead. Clock still being addressed here, and while we wait, let's go to Matt Weiner in our Times Square studios in New York. Matt.
All right, Mike, true freshman Matt Barkley's off to a good start in his Trojan quarterbacking career for USC, and he's been handing it off effectively as well. This is Allen Bradford for 43 yards and a touchdown. The Trojans threatening again. Barkley is 7 of 9, but that's nothing compared to what Jimmy Clausen is doing to Nevada. He's 11 of 13 with 3 touchdowns just before halftime, all Irish.
Felt so bad for Jimmy Clausen when he first started there, because the offensive line, I don't know that it could have stopped my grandmother from getting into the backfield. And Clausen never had a chance to throw. He is a very skilled kid, very talented quarterback.
Reset the game clock for 3 minutes, 2 seconds, please. 3:02. The clock will start on my signal.
And you just knew as soon as they got some guys around him that could protect him, he could shine.
They started looking better last year in pads. You know, they got away from the Aaron Taylors that we watched for years, dominated Notre Dame. They had no attitude up front. And you're right, Mike, these guys just weren't physical up front, and there was no way Clawson could get it done. But he's got the skills.
Yes, he does.
He's got the arm. He's got the composure. And now Charlie Weiss is saying that he's going to be making the calls and focused on coaching the quarterback. Today it's paying off because Nevada's not a bad team.
No, they're not. They should have an outstanding offense. And the clock is, they're really having a tough time with it. It was at 2 seconds. Now it's at 3:02 and running. That issues the entire game. Pillar against the four-man rush. Throws for West. Tipped and caught. Went through West's hands as he was looking for a defender right into the arms of Arnheim. And the converted quarterback makes the grab.
Yeah, one former quarterback helping out an existing one here. But again, I see blue jerseys around the football. In our meetings I was talking about a few years ago, when I watched Michigan's defense, I didn't see a lot of helmets around the ball. Today it's different. They see where it's supposed to go, where they're supposed to be, and they're responding.
Western Michigan has not converted a third down in this ballgame until now. Good pass to Nunez. That's one of the few plays that has had any rhythm to it for this Western Michigan offense.
They got to the line of scrimmage. You know, pick it up. You know, if you're sitting in the back seat and it's not working, might as well jump up front and take a run at it. Spin the wheels.
Clock running. We've hit the 2-minute mark. Hiller throws, and that one's incomplete. Bounced on the ground in front of Ansel Ponder. Stops the clock at the minute 57 mark. Western Michigan would love to get on the board just to have something to hold on to going into the locker room. A tackler to the 45.
I like to stay at the line of scrimmage. You know, you just got to change it up, become a little more offensive.
I think they need to stay in this the rest of the game to have any hope. Hiller against the blitz. Nice catch by Ponder and a good throw by Hiller under pressure.
Absolutely. You know, a lot of times when you do this, a player starts to react and have ability takeover as opposing out there thinking so much, thinking through the game. Outstanding catch. Good job with his feet.
First time they have crossed midfield. They said Ponder worked very hard in the spring. He's a freshman. And his hands got better dramatically during that time. West. Nice change of direction, and West down to the 39-yard line. Well, Michigan, I think, playing a little bit of a prevent defense, trying to avoid giving up the big play, and they're giving up some yardage. Killer. Nunez with a good throw. And he gets out of bounds at the 30. Floyd makes the stop for Michigan.
All right, there's the NFL arm. That's the first time I've seen that.
Yeah, the deep out.
Deep out, there you go. That's what they're talking about. Todd McShay of ESPN, one of our analysts, that the guru of the future guys.
That's right.
As Todd is. You know, he's got him in there in that fourth or fifth rated quarterback of juniors and seniors. You know, got some upside.
Well, he's a very bright kid. Already has his degree, a 4.0 grade point average in sales and marketing. Ponder. Out of bounds at about the 17-yard line. Still plenty of time to go in the half, 57 seconds. First seven drives netted only 25 yards. This drive has already gone 63. Here's our trivia question. Michigan lost two straight home openers. When was the last time they lost three straight? You have to go back to the Duffy-Daugherty era at Michigan State. 50, 51, and 52 when they lost three straight. West swallowed up. Look at all the blue jerseys. Now they thought they'd cross him up with a running play. Michigan's defense wasn't buying it.
Mike, jump back over a little bit here and talk about the Notre Dame issue, you know, and the team and the pressure. Opening weekend, you know, there's going to be a lot of different things now that they can look at against this Michigan offense. Things like Tate Forcier. So John Tenuta and that Irish defense, they'll have some film now of Forcier and his skills.
Western Michigan from the 19-yard line trying to put something on the scoreboard here at the end of the half. Keller got everything out of it he could, stepped out of bounds at the 18-yard line right at the sticks with 41 seconds to go.
Well, that tells you right there.
And about 10.
That just tells you all you need to know about how this game has gone to this point.
Doesn't
and what this drive has meant.
Third and 10 for Hiller. Four-man rush for Michigan. And they got Hiller and took him down, and it's Craig Rowe, a true freshman from Scottsdale, Arizona, number 88. And Ryan Van Bergen, number 53, finished him off. But the outside rush of Rowe, 6'4", 238.
You see the push inside, and it's a compliment of the defensive line and the secondary. Secondary covering everybody up. D-line, 4 against 5, just blown right by those big bodies.
John Potter will come on to try a 44-yard field goal with 33 seconds left. Can the Broncos get on the scoreboard here at the Big House? No. Snap hooked it left. And a really good drive comes up empty.
You know, obviously, Greg Robinson and his defense, they have goals for the season. Statistically, it means something to the players and to the coaches. So, you know,
sure.
3 points here. There's still a goose egg on the scoreboard. Michigan last year, their defense gave up a lot of points. They just were fairly inept, to say the least, and scoring an 84th in the country. But 28 a game, 28.9, that goose egg looks good up there right now.
Michigan is going to let the clock run down. There's going to be a lot of happy players in that locker room in the opener of 2009 as they have a 31-point lead over Western Michigan, a team that some of the pundits were saying could come in here and maybe spring the upset. Let's go down to Quint.
Coach, given the nature of this week, how do you best explain the response that you received from your guys today?
As I said many times, our guys have been focused all week. We've had a good first half, but we got a lot of things we still got to clean up. Some typical first game mistakes, and they got a whole nother half to play.
What was most impressive about Tate Forcier?
Well, he seems like he's played before. You know, for being a first time out there as a true freshman, he's really been calm and composed. You know, we got some things to clean up, but I'm really proud of his composure.
Bernard Robinson touchdown run. What happened on that play?
Well, he bobbled a snap a little bit, but when he goes anywhere, he goes fast. And he went the wrong way fast, and he made a great play. And we're going to try to get our execution a little bit stronger in the second half.
Thanks, Coach. Okay. Mike.
Our score at the half, Quint, Michigan 31, Western Michigan nothing. Stay tuned for the halftime report from the studio after these messages.
Report. John Saunders alongside of Jesse Palmer. It's week one, which is kind of almost like punchers in round one, trying to feel each other out, see which teams are good, which ones are down. But for the Big Ten, it's a chance to make a statement because a lot of people think they are down. Joe Paterno says, not my Nittany Lions. He's got Darryl Clark finding Chaz Powell 8 yards.
Nice job by Darryl Clark squaring his shoulders as he rolls to his left to ensure the accurate throw.
And then Clark again. Look at the protection. action finds Derek Moy 22 yards.
After Penn State lost three of its top four receivers in school history, this wide receiver unit came up big today for Darrell Clark.
And Clark took advantage as well. Clark, the career high, 353 yards. But again, you see the great protection. Derek Moy had six receptions for 138 yards and a touchdown as well. Northern Iowa against Iowa. Things were a little more difficult for the Hawkeyes. This is Northern Iowa lining up for what would be a game-winning field goal on first down. It's blocked. Iowa needs to fall on the ball. They don't. And because the ball doesn't cross the line of scrimmage, they get a do-over, and this one is blocked again.
Give Iowa special teams credit for showing up not once but twice, getting big surges to block potential game-winning field goals. They survive by the skin of their teeth.
Syracuse's story during the offseason, of course, was Greg Paulus coming in at quarterback after 4 years running Mike Krzyzewski's basketball team, and this time he goes to Mike Williams for 29 yards. Orange are down 14-10, but then Paulus in overtime scrambling. He probably wants this one back.
And here you see the rust of not having played a game in 4 years on third down. You need to throw this football away, give yourself a chance. He forces it into the end zone for the huge turnover.
And Minnesota just has to come back and kick the field goal 35 yards, and Minnesota wins it 23-20 is the final. Paulus 19 of 31, 167 yards, a touchdown. Some more scores. It's a sweep, if you will, for the Big Ten. Michigan State over Montana State, Northwestern over Towson, and Purdue knocks off Toledo as well. So the Big Ten, if you were going to give them a grade on the day, what would it be?
Well, it was good in some cases, but less than impressive in others. And I think when you look at number six, Ohio State, struggling with Navy, you look at a top 25 team in Iowa that needs to block two potential game-winning field goals late to beat Northern Iowa. And then finally, Minnesota having to go to overtime to beat Syracuse, not overly impressive. This is the first week of college football. This is generally when we're going to see a lot of offenses work the kinks out. But needless to say, some teams barely surviving here in the Big Ten week one.
Well, a lot of people are not going to pick the Big Ten in this poll. The Cooper Tire poll question is, which conference will the national title come from? And right now, most people liking the Big 12 and the Big Ten down there at four. Pac-10, surprisingly, only at four right now. And the SEC all the way up at 27. This is the Cooper Tires halftime report. Tate Forsay, he's a freshman, but didn't look like it on this play. Buys himself some time and tosses the pass. Touchdown to Hemingway, their first of the game. They're rolling over Western Michigan 31-0. John Saunders and Jesse Palmer. And that was one of the bigger question marks coming in because of the controversy in Ann Arbor this week about did they practice too much, did they not practice too much. This team really pulled together in the locker room.
If you ask me, this is the statement game so far today. So many distractions heading into this football game. Everybody wondered how this football team was going to respond, and they came out of the tunnels guns firing. They're hitting on all cylinders right now, playing great offense and defense. Both true freshman quarterbacks doing a great job. Tate Forsay in the passing game, Dernard Robinson in the running game.
This their first game of the regular season, their last game of the regular season. Of course, they'll face the Ohio State Buckeyes, who open against Navy today. Terrell Pryor, does he have his eyes on USC next week? Well, looks like it does here. Picked off by Emmett Merchant. And Merchant returns into the Buckeyes' 33-yard line. Ricky Dobbs had thrown for a couple of passes, runs for this one. 24 yards on the touchdown. Dobbs, 9 of 13, 156 yards and 83 through the air. But this, the mistake he makes.
Ohio State's defense certainly struggled in this football game. But at the biggest point and the most critical juncture of this game, the defense showed up. They're able to ice the win with an interception, but they barely escape.
They face USC next week, and true freshman Matt Barkley, the first true freshman ever to start for USC, hands off to Joe McKnight. McKnight loses the handle, fumbles it. San Jose State recovers. They're not done with turning the ball over either later in the first. First and 10, Barkley completes a short pass to McCoy, but McCoy gets popped, and the ball comes loose.
San Jose State's defense was flying around early in this game, getting hats on footballs, and that caused big turnovers.
Stephon Johnson finally hangs on to the ball, and goes in pretty much untouched, 4 yards for the touchdown. Then Stephon Johnson, it's only 2 yards, but watch the speed as he gets to the corner. Touchdown USC, not done on the ground. Allen Bradford will add a longer one as USC just keeps throwing players at you.
And the beauty of USC's running game is they are literally six deep at the running back position. They can bring fresh bodies in, wear you down on the defensive side of the football. That is the strength right now of this USC Trojan team.
So USC right now rolling 28-3. If you look ahead to next week and you want to use last year as a barometer, well, it's not good news for Ohio State. Lost 35-3, but that was in Los Angeles. Now they get them at home. But again, based on what I've seen today, I'd be concerned if I was a Buckeyes fan.
I think there's more cause for concern for Ohio State right now because of the way they play defense against Navy. And I know it's very, very difficult to game plan for a team that runs the triple option. Navy has led the Football Bowl subdivision in rushing the last 4 years in a row. What concerned me most today watching this football game was all the big plays in the passing game from Navy. There were bombs dropped over the heads of those Ohio State defenders. They're going to have to buckle up and get ready for a USC team that's going to come in. They're going to force the football down your throat. They're going to run it, play physical. They got a true freshman playing quarterback. We already saw how dangerous they could be running the football. They're six deep at that position. If I'm Ohio State, buckle up, load the box on defense, get ready to play downhill because USC is going to run the rock. You better be ready defensively if you're Ohio State.
And that freshman quarterback, it'll be his second game, which, believe it or not, yeah, as you know, starting as a true freshman, that makes a big difference.
Huge
game
difference,
two.
No question.
All right, Michigan, their next opponent will be the Fighting Irish of Notre Dame. And Notre Dame looks pretty good. Jimmy Clausen with 3 touchdown passes.
Jimmy Clausen has been automatic in this game, particularly when pushing the football vertically downfield. John Tenuta's defense dialing it up right now. Remember, this Nevada team last year, third best in the country running the football. Colin Kaepernick, a quarterback, he was the WAC player of the year. No offense to speak of right now if you're Nevada.
Georgia facing Oklahoma State. And Joe Cox, he actually had to take a different plane for the rest of the team because he had the flu. But it doesn't look like here he finds Michael Moore in double coverage.
Yeah, Michael Moore goes up and tries to high point this football. And all intent and purposes, that play should be picked, but give Michael Moore a lot of credit for the concentration.
Zach Robinson to Dez Bryant. Brian Evans says hello.
Very physical play early in this game from Georgia defensively, trying to take the big target, Dez Bryant, out of the game.
Yeah, Evans got the worst of that one as well. And Zach Robinson this time looking for his big target with the big hands again, and Bryant is there to haul this one in, 46 yards.
It's going to be key all game long that Oklahoma State is going to move Dez Bryant around so that Georgia cannot double cover him. You see them finding him deep downfield there to take the lead at halftime.
Missouri facing Illinois. And Missouri having to replace Chase Daniel, one of the great quarterbacks in Big 12 history. Blaine Gabbert fakes the handoff. Wide open Wes Kemp takes it down the sidelines. 49 yards for the touchdown. Tigers with a 10-0 lead. And Ron Zook's team struggling right now, down 16-3.
Well, no Chase Daniel, no problem right now in Missouri. Blaine Gabbert getting it done both through the air and on the ground. It's a little bit of a new wrinkle in Missouri's offense this year, and you're seeing it right there from their quarterback.
There's Baylor leading Wake Forest 17-7. Robert Griffin, as you called him, the best player that nobody's heard of.
No, you're absolutely right. And I would argue when people talk about Colt McCoy, Sam Bradford, Tim Tebow, I'd say Robert Griffin just as dangerous as those players. He can hurt you with his arms and his legs. I'll tell you what, one of the fastest players in college football.
Just happens to be in one of the tougher conferences in college football. It's hard to shine. Don't forget tonight in primetime, No. 5 Alabama takes on No. 7 Virginia Tech. We'll talk about that and look ahead in a moment.
Today's AT&T All-America Flashback, Mike Hart. On October 23rd, 2004, this workhorse running back carried the ball 33 times for 206 yards. Hart scored Michigan's only touchdown that day, catapulting the Wolverines to a 16-14 victory over the Purdue Boilermakers. Text VOTE to 345-345 on your AT&T wireless phone to play All-America Trivia for a chance to win a trip to the national championship game.
Tonight on ABC in primetime. Alabama out of the SEC. Virginia Tech out of the ACC. John Saunders and Jesse Palmer. And I realize it's a different team, but last year Clemson came into this game against Alabama with so much hype. Everybody thought they were the best team in the ACC, and they got clobbered by Alabama. Virginia Tech, how did they avoid a similar fate?
I think it's all going to come down to the trenches, in particular the offensive line for Virginia Tech versus the front seven for Alabama. I spoke to Brian Steinspring, the offensive coordinator at Virginia Tech. He said this may be the best front seven in all of college football they're going to face. They're really going to have to assert their will up front, running the football, do a great job protecting for Tyrod Taylor. Otherwise, this could be a very, very long night for the Virginia Tech Hokies.
And make it look again like it did last year, which is what they're hoping to avoid, because a lot of people think Virginia Tech has a chance at a national championship as well as Alabama. Back with more in a moment.
Welcome back to the Big House, where Michigan leads Western Michigan 31-0. And to the Big House, where Michigan leads Western Michigan 31-0. And if you are a Wolverine fan, you have been waiting for this for an entire year, because it has been a miserable year. 3-9 last year, all the allegations in the press. What fun this had to be for Rich Rodriguez, the staff, and the players.
When Coach Rod talked to Quint going in at halftime, he was already getting back to the old mood, right? You know, now we got to execute better. We're going to work on some things. Emotions out the window. All the questions gone. So I expect here in the second half that we're going to see a Michigan team that's been told, you're young. We're still learning. We've got a long ways to go to be perfect. So execution is going to be very important for Michigan in the second half. As for Western Michigan, they're a good football team expected to compete for the MAC Conference Championship. They've got to come out and execute and do something well.
All right, what's our city inside view for this week? Take a look at this first half. Forcier looked pretty good, didn't he?
Well, I had a guy stop me at the concession stand a while ago, and he said, may the Forcier be with you. Michigan's already all over this young man. His composure, his playmaking ability, his ability to see the field and not get rattled. Patience, knowledge, making the right calls. Tate Forcier not playing like a true freshman at all. And you alluded to it, Mike, earlier. The fact that he had all the reps in the spring, Nick Sheridan, the quarterback, the junior, had some problems health-wise. I mean, it's showing now that that's coming through.
You made up that line, didn't you? May the Forcier be with you.
The guy downstairs going into the restroom says, may the Forcier be with you.
I'm not that clever.
Let's get him as a guest in the second half. Right? Let's see what else he can come up with. That's pretty good. Thanks for passing it on, though.
There you go.
Michigan will get the ball to start the second half. Stoneman 22, Odoms 9 on deep. Odoms wrapped up shy of the 25-yard line. Here is our Pacific Life game summary. The numbers from the first half, and boy, look at this. Minus 2 yards rushing for Western Michigan, only 81 through the air, and 289 total yards for the Wolverines. Last year, Michigan averaged 291 yards a game. They are too shy of that in this half.
And, you know, we're getting carried away, and rightfully so, with the offense, because that's been so lacking. But the defense at Michigan today has matched every bit the offense.
Good point. Brown fumbles. Michigan got it back. It looked like Stephen Schilling made the recovery after Deontay LeGreer knocked it loose from Carlos Brown.
You know, and again, this is a result here of maybe an aggressive defense coming in, tackling. Ball carrier, when you get in that position, it's got to be two hands on it. You got to know that it's coming from all directions.
Adams has
Western Michigan going for the ball again, and Odoms will lead them about a third and two.
Simple play like that, though, Mike. You know, the getting the ball out, a catchable ball on time, so the rhythm of the play develops.
Well, if this truly was an audition for 4CA, he's got the lead. You see the freshman changing the play here. Brown on the toss. First down across the 35 to the 37-yard line. Brown playing in place of Brandon Miner, the 1,000-yard back from a year ago, who is out with a sprained ankle. We talked to him yesterday. He's hopeful that he'll be ready to go next week when they face Notre Dame.
Depth is a great problem to have, right, if you're a coach. And right now in the running back position, they have three or four that they could throw out there as starters.
Forcier after the fake. Good throw and a catch by Hemingway. Hemingway with two touchdown catches this year. This game, nobody for Michigan had two touchdown catches last year.
And you know, somebody's got to step up and take the role. Michigan's had it for years where some receiver steps up, and Junior Hemingway, only a sophomore at 6'1", has that type of body, a bigger body that you're used to seeing at Michigan.
He limps off after five catches, 103 yards, and two scores in this game. Brown picking his way. Mariel Armstrong, strong safety, in on the stop.
One thing we're seeing here today is a Michigan offensive line downfield blocking. We haven't seen that in a while. And big bodies that are usually, you know, pound a guy, get him in the ground, and they're down the field today.
Forcier throwing on the run, got it out to Matthews.
There's so much depth to this offense that Tate Forcier, they're going to unveil more and more as he can handle it. But just like that play there, that could have been a run by the quarterback, but he saw the bubble on the outside and he pulls up and throws the ball. Forces that defense to cover the entire field.
You know, I was just going to say the same thing, that they really haven't shown anywhere near all of this option offense, because we remember what it looked like in Rich Rodriguez last year at West Virginia. They could run virtually any play you could think of out of that offense.
And, you know, that's going to create a problem for John Tenuta next week in preparing at Notre Dame as a defensive coordinator for this, because he really hasn't seen the quarterback zone read today, the staple of this offense.
Yeah. And Western Michigan's defense right now, they're dragging. They're sucking for air. Been on this field a long, long time against the Michigan offense. Forcier under pressure and throws incomplete. The only reason was that pressure. Savoy was open, and Zajac, who started last year at middle linebacker, was coming after the freshman Tate Forcier.
You know, and for Western Michigan, their defense, there has to be small victories on plays that you have, and you see the attack of the quarterback there and forces the error throw.
Third down, 3 yards to go. Forcier, straight quarterback run, and he didn't make it. Pretty good defense by Austin Pritchard, the strong side linebacker, probably the best player on this unit. Fourth and three, this would be about a 45-yard field goal attempt, and we get our first look at Nick Sheridan. The junior, four starts a year ago, played in 10 games, fractured his leg in the spring, didn't get any reps at all, so he comes in on fourth and three. Or check it, fourth and about a yard and a half. And he'll hand it off to Michael Shaw, who got the first down at the 25-yard line. And Sheridan will stay on. 6'1", 218 pounds. Boy, he was in a tough situation a year ago. Here's a young man who walked on, was sixth on the depth chart when he first arrived here. His dad, Bill, as you see, the Giants defensive coordinator, he wasn't even going to play football here. He was just going to come to school at Michigan. Shaw's got some speed inside the 15 to about the 14-yard line. Kevin Grady, the fullback, threw him a good block to spring the run.
And you know, comes in, fourth and one, and hands off the ball. No big deal, right? Wrong. He made the right call. He got them in a play that got the first down. At the line of scrimmage, managing the game, making the right call at the line to be successful.
He is one of the three quarterbacks who are going to play. Fourcier and Robinson are both true freshmen here. Sheridan to the goal line about a foot shy. But there is a flag down back at the 15-yard line. The first indication it's coming back.
Holding by the offense, number 60, 10-yard penalty. Replay first down.
David Mossman, a fifth-year senior, the right guard, called for the hold. Well, it was a nice run by Sheridan.
Yeah, and a good, and here's your read, too, and it's backside away from any really relevance to the play. I mean, that's one of those calls that you're like, okay, maybe a little mercy. He was engaged backside, but again, nice call by Sheridan, showing a little zip up the field.
This is about the only thing Michigan has done wrong today. Six flags, five of them thrown against the offense. First and 20 after the penalty for the junior Nick Sheridan. Pump fake, then throws deep, nobody home. His receiver Matthews pulled up short. And when Sheridan pumped, Matthews didn't go anywhere.
Yeah, you know, the corner didn't bite, didn't buy into it. And right now we're seeing this Michigan offense look to the sideline, making some adjustments, and the coaches making calls from the sidelines for the players. So again, this is it's all part of the coordination and the growing and the evolution, you know, everybody getting to work together out there.
Sheridan, the least mobile of these quarterbacks. He is not the guy with sprinter speed as Zajac makes the tackle on him. But his advantage is his time in at quarterback in any system, and he played a full year in it last year.
And I think everybody respects and admires a walk-on, particularly a quarterback at Michigan, who's come out here and he's had great attitude, a work ethic, a team guy.
Sheridan, and it's intercepted at the goal line. It's a scrum for the football, but they are indicating Western Michigan has it. Deshaun Lawrence stepped in front of the receiver, and the first quarterback mistake by Michigan in this game is made by Sheridan.
And the first play made by Western Michigan, it seems like, defensively today. Coming up and for Lawrence, fighting for the ball.
Sheridan talking to Letario Savoy. That just looked like a good defensive play as the ball was a little slow in getting there.
Yeah, I tell you what he's talking to now. The wide receiver's got to work and fight and come back and help, too. You know, you got a ball sitting out there floating through the air. You got to go fight and bail your quarterback out.
Timeout, 9:11 to go, third quarter. Still a shutout for Michigan.
College football in high definition is presented by Vizio.
106,000 people showed up today at Michigan to see the opener. Maybe three have left. The rest are still here and enjoying every moment of it. Tim Hiller at quarterback after the interception. Western Michigan starts inside the 3-yard line. West. Shy of the five, we go to the studio. Matt Weiner in Times Square. Matt.
All right, Mike, time for our AT&T All-America Player of the Week update. It was a successful debut for Lane Kiffin and his Volunteers, and Jonathan Crompton had a huge day against Western Kentucky, 233 yards through the air and a career-high 5 touchdown passes. Text the word VOTE to 345-345 on your AT&T wireless phone. You could win a trip to the national championship.
Thank you, Matt. 8 minutes, 30 seconds to go in the third quarter here. Western Michigan has had one chance to score, and they missed a field goal. They have stopped Michigan short of the goal line on a good drive. Now trying to get out of the shadow of their own goal line. West out to the 9. They have to reach past the 13 for a first down. Brandon Aaron with the tackle.
Lane Kiffin will be an interesting twist in that SEC, obviously. He's come in, he's flamboyant, he talks, he's aggressive, he's tenacious, he's bringing that Pete Carroll mentality over there. They've got athletes at Tennessee, always have athletes.
They do. And they have a heck of a defensive coordinator. His dad, Monty Kiffin, is as good as they get on that side of the ball. Hiller's got the first down. That was a nice throw to Caleb Ravenel. 6 feet tall, a junior, 190 pounds, and a good throw by Hiller, who right now has not been able to do much at all with this Michigan defense. He has not been in rhythm most of the game.
1, 2, 3, plants the right foot in the ground, lets the ball go. Receiver right where he's supposed to be, continues running. And you know, the second half, for his resume, absolutely important for the NFL scouts as they evaluate down the road.
He has not shown us that kind of skill that we expected to see out of him. He throws to Ravenel this time with a lot of pressure right in his face, and Donovan Warren makes the tackle.
And, you know, just like that throw there, he puts the ball on the outside shoulder, the back shoulder, so that the receiver can catch it. You know, many times players come into a game and they're on the road opening weekend, and it's the big house. And you've had so many things you've talked about in the offseason. We want to do this in the big house. And they thought they were going to come in here and win this game. All of a sudden, it's 31 to nothing, and you're like, holy cow, wake me up from this bad
game. Yeah. Four wide receivers as they've gone to a more open offense, and they're just going to try to chuck it around here in the second half. Possession receiver Robert Arnheim makes the catch. Let's get down to the sideline. Quint, what do you have?
Mike, after halftime, I spoke with Western Michigan coach Bill Cubitt about Tim Hiller. The coach was pretty positive about his team's performance, most disappointed with his quarterback's play. His quarterback, who has tremendously high expectations, he said he's out of sync, there's no flow, there's no rhythm. He did point to the knee injury. Keep in mind, this is a quarterback who had surgery on January 8th, an ACL surgery, didn't get any reps in the spring. The coach kind of hinting that he felt his quarterback was a little rusty.
Well, that would be a good reason, wouldn't it? Hiller throws in the flat here again, and really busy on this series is Caleb Ravenel. And he's out to about the 42-yard line. Cubitt certainly has this program going in the right direction. In his fifth year, they have won 29 games in the first four. That is the second best streak this program has ever had. Last year, of course, they were 9-4. That tied a school record. But they're going to be very disappointed with this opening effort. Hiller again in trouble, and down he goes. The nose tackle, Mike Martin, out of Redford, Michigan, all 292 pounds of him, wrapped up Hiller and wouldn't let go.
Yeah, you know, there's nothing a quarterback can do about this. When you're getting beat right up the middle, right in the heart of where you're trying to turn and throw the football, Martin, a high motor, big, strong, powerful player. And these athletes at Michigan, the very hard season training that they've gone through, you're starting to see it. I am in this big offensive line, but these defensive linemen in Michigan, quick and aggressive.
Blitz coming. Hiller throws sideline. That's complete. There was a push there as Nunez makes the catch. He may have gotten away with offensive interference. Gain of 23.
You might have something there, Mike. I mean, Nunez looks like just after there's incidental contact between the two, they kind of get tied up a little bit right here. Both kind of pushing. Okay, okay. Yeah, just
footwork. Oh, I see what it was. Warren got caught as they crossed feet.
Turf monster.
And Warren went down and left Nunez wide open. That was the longest play of the ball game for Western Michigan. West has not had a lot of success. He gets down to the 36-yard line. Second time they have been across midfield in this contest.
Starting to see something, though. Why this is a good football team expected to contend for the MAC title.
Well, you said they should go more up-tempo, and they have been much better since they have.
It's been a totally defensive game by them offensively.
Sure has.
Just very, very in a shell, afraid.
That's a great way to put it. Slant batted down by Brandon Graham, the defensive end who is so good at rushing the passer on that short drop. He's not going to get there, and he was very aware of that, got his hands up.
And you know what? This, again, I go back to communication, knowledge, understanding of what you're trying to do. Here he is here. Watch, like you say, hands up. When the ball's gone from the quarterback's hand, get your hands up in the air, block the pass. Greg Robinson teaches, they listen, they talk amongst themselves. There are 11 players out there that understand everybody else's responsibility.
Third and long for Hiller. Pressure coming, Graham had him, but he got rid of it. Arnheim down to the 26-yard line. Brandon Graham coming as hard as he could, got there maybe a half a step too late.
Yeah, you give hats off to Tim Hiller for realizing that expect pressure coming from the right side. Brandon Graham, 55, is trying to play quarterback for Western Michigan, and he's done a pretty good job of it this afternoon. But that's a great job of seeing his receiver, Hiller, getting the ball off, avoiding the sack.
It's the best drive Hiller has had. 6 out of 7, throwing 66 yards. Here's the option. West goes straight up the middle. That's the biggest hole he's had today, and picks up 8, maybe 9 yards.
Starting to see a little bit of balance here in this Western Michigan offense. A little run, a little pass. It's slowed down a little bit, the inside part of Michigan's defense, but it's amazing what balance will do for you.
And it's really important to this offense, I think, to get something on the board right here, particularly if it's a touchdown, just to give themselves a little confidence. Maybe it won't mean much in this game, but it will down the road. Hiller under center. And I'm not sure what that was intended for. Nunez, and about 6 feet over his head. Let's go to the studio and Matt Weiner. Matt.
All right, Mike, thank you very much. Missouri has to replace Chase Daniel this season. Sophomore Blaine Gabbert is the new quarterback for the Tigers, and he is having quite a day in his debut. 3 touchdown passes without a pick. This one to Jared Perry. It's all Tigers over their border rivals, Illinois. Dan Mullen making his coaching debut for Mississippi State. His Bulldogs lead Jackson State at half, 14-0.
Dan Mullen is going to make a difference there. He is really a good coach.
As best you can do there, whatever that is.
Yes. Alex Carter is in at quarterback. On the short yardage play,
I think, you know, Bill Cubitt, the play before this last one, he was out there, what are you doing? You can see him like, hey, what are you throwing the ball? What's going on?
Well, it was an odd pass. It was so far over Nunez's head. Now it's fourth down, and they're obviously in a situation where they have to go for it. Hiller on the half roll and throws low and wide of Nunez. So they turn it over on downs. And the announced crowd today, 109,019. And the official capacity here is 106 and change. What a heck of a turnout for the start of the 2009 season.
Tim Hiller does not have his legs yet. You know, Quint just talked about it. He does not have his legs back.
ESPN
ESPN's College Football on ABC. Brought to you by Dick's Sporting Goods. Every season starts at Dick's. Nissan, who invites you to shift the way you move. And AT&T, your world delivered.
That's the weight room, one of the state-of-the-art facilities they have here at Michigan. The new indoor practice facility is just ridiculous. It's so nice.
Yeah, it's so nice. They had no pretty boy weights in there. I avoided it. I need the...
No hand weights, huh?
No tubes.
Forcier out in the flat. Michigan was so much more team speed than they had a year ago. That was Kelvin Brady. Well, you want to go fast? How about the NASCAR Sprint Cup Series? Back for Labor Day weekend in the South. Only two races remain for those drivers like Kyle Busch, Casey Kane, and Mark Martin to get into the chase. They're on the bubble right now. The Sprint Cup Series at Atlanta. Our coverage begins tomorrow night at 7 o'clock on ESPN. Forcier with the carry. I'm surprised we haven't seen more of Denard Robinson after the nice plays he had in the first half, including that dazzling touchdown.
Well, but you know what? You think back now. He dribbled the ball on the ground,
yes,
picks it up, ran a
yes,
Mach 1 for a touchdown. So it wasn't like he executed great football. He just had that speed.
Forcier throws again, intended for Brady, who played 2 years as the point guard in the basketball team.
I got one for you, and we asked Coach Rod about it yesterday, but what if Tate Forcier really is the guy? Okay, how can you justify keep Denard Robinson's speed and athleticism over there? And ask him, could he might fill the void or the role that Steve Slayton played at West Virginia? Great speed, another compliment back there. He said, no, this kid's a quarterback. We're going to keep him at quarterback, and it's a guy that gives us depth, if nothing else.
Michigan punting for the first time since midway through the first quarter. Fair catch made it to 36 after a punt of 37 yards. Robert Arnheim with the hands. Western Michigan ball when we come back. Only 41 seconds left to go third quarter. Still a shutout, Michigan. Thursday, September 24th, the whole world will black out at exactly the same time. Everyone will see a flash of their own future, and mankind will take on the greatest mystery it's ever faced. ABC's Flash Forward, a new series, premieres Thursday, September 24th, 8, 7 Central on ABC. I've seen the promos. I love the idea of that show. Western Michigan, the last two drives, they've racked up some yards, still have nothing to show for it. Pillar on the keeper. The man's got some skills, doesn't he?
Yeah, but he's dragging that right leg along with him. And it's a confidence builder game for him. Obviously, coming back from a knee surgery in January is something that an athlete needs time to get through. This is playing against a good, aggressive defense today was more than a challenge for Western Michigan's offensive line, but he's going to be okay. You know, for the long run, they'll learn a lot from this game.
Well, he had the other leg done in 2006. That cost him that season. So he has had both surgically repaired. That's going to be interference. Donovan Warren had the receiver, well, what, a bear hug? That's not going to work.
It looked like the receiver was trying to go through him, but Warren didn't know that the ball was inside.
Actually, there's two flags down. There's one in the backfield.
There are two fouls on the play, holding by the offense, number 63. Pass interference, defense, number 6. Those penalties offset. Replay, first down.
The holding foul is on Wasikowski, who was the center.
That's a tough one there. It looks like the receiver is trying to come back. The DB was just, he would stay in this place.
Yeah,
Warren was right there.
He certainly has a right to his position. But it's a wash, and they'll do first down all over again. That's Glennis Thompson with a rare carry. And there is another flag down in the secondary.
Dead ball. Personal foul by the defense, number 6. 15-yard penalty. Automatic first down. That's the end of the third quarter.
Donovan Warren picking up back-to-back big penalties. Pass interference and a personal foul. It's also the end of the quarter. 31-0, Michigan.
Michigan. Kickoff week.
Ready to start the fourth quarter here at Michigan. The Wolverines with a wonderfully successful opener so far. They lead 31-0 over Western Michigan. The Broncos have the football. First and 10 in Michigan territory. Hiller slipped right out of his hands. And it's intercepted at the 34-yard line. Mouton, the 6'2", 228-pound inside linebacker, and that ball just came right out of Hiller's hands, and Mouton with the diving pick.
We saw what we thought was a loose ball coming from Hiller's hand in the last series on a screen to the outside. Missed communication there. And again, right here, the ball just... It's almost the form, the delivery of it. I haven't watched this guy for years, but what's going on? I mean, you wonder if that's a first time this has happened occurrence, or has
well,
he had
remember
a tendency?
The pass he tried to throw to Nunez in the flat that he threw over his head by about 6 feet.
That's a three ball today that we know of.
Right. Denard Robinson is in. He of the blinding speed. And Robinson out to the 43-yard line. They call him Shoelace. He hasn't tied him since he was 7 years old.
That's unreal. But the Velcro does keep the foot of the shoe.
Oh, don't mess up a good story.
Okay.
Let's not let the facts get in the way of something that can become legendary. There he goes again across midfield down to the 48-yard line. Grady threw a nice block for him. Well, we've had people with shoe-related nicknames before. Shoeless Joe, one of the great ballplayers of all time. Billy White Shoes Johnson, wonderful punt returner for Houston and Atlanta. And now we have Shoelace. And I hope you saw Quint's explanation early in the ballgame about that Velcro that allows him to keep the shoelaces untied. But when you have that kind of a track record, going to keep them untied until somebody forces you to tie them, and Rich Rodriguez is not going to do that.
Yeah, that is, you know, everybody has their style and they're unique in their ways, I suppose. And if he can keep bursting by defenders like he did early in the game after dribbling the ball on the carpet.
I mean, I'd be afraid to do that in a booth, let alone trying to play quarterback.
That's why I wear boots. We don't have to lace up anything.
Second and long, Robinson takes off on the quarterback draw. It was interesting that Rich Rodriguez said there is no special package for him. He's got the entire offense to run, but it doesn't look like mentally that's what he wants to do. It looks like he wants to take the snap and go with it.
I've seen several plays when he's in there, quarterback draws, quarterback designed runs for sure. And at this point here, I mean, in this audition session, at least today, he doesn't have the balance in his game that Tate Forcier does. Nowhere even close.
No, true. But he's only had 3.5 weeks on campus. Right. So to learn this offense,
I'd bunch you up and play 8 men in the box and dare him to throw.
Well, if they dared him, he just cut loose intended for Matthews, and it's knocked away by Keith Dixon. He certainly got a strong enough arm, but they'll turn it over.
Well, I had a strong arm too, but that didn't mean I could throw it to my receiver. But you know what? It's been a successful day for the quarterback system here at Michigan. I think they found Tate Forcier their guy for now. Denard Robinson will have his role. Certainly a package, and Nick Sheridan's there if they need something that's stable.
Great evaluation. Punt taken at the 12. And Western Michigan will start its next series inside its own 15-yard line after a 42-yard punt and a 3-yard return. 12:24 to go from the Big House.
Welcome.
Michigan with the lead here in the fourth quarter, 31-0. Each week on our broadcast, my partner Craig James will deliver his opinion and insight with the Pony Express. This week, Craig, the question is, in light of the controversy here in Michigan, what are the demands on football players, and how have they changed from the time when you played to now when your son is playing at Texas Tech?
Yeah, it's changed tremendously, obviously. I mean, when we played, it was competitive, and you wanted to do well. You wanted to be prepared above and beyond. But, you know, like on a Sunday, for instance, you know, we'd go over and we'd have film session. We'd run some 100-yard dashes. And next thing you know, we're at Pacho's raising the flag for the next round of beef, you know, or micheladas. We weren't sticking around at 11 o'clock at night, I promise you. My son, Adam, at Texas Tech, that's all they do is football. And a lot of that's on his own.
Drew Birdie is in at quarterback for Hiller. And we'll see if we can find out the particular reason, although Hiller has thrown a couple of passes really off target. I'm not sure if anything's wrong with his hand or his finger right now. Back to the commitment that young men have to make today in the light of what everybody else is doing. You have to be competitive with the guy you're playing.
No, there's no doubt about it. And I think that's what's happened here at Michigan, is that you've had a few players that didn't like their situation, and they've made some comments about the overall time commitment required, when in fact it's really their own personal agenda and their own problem. But you know, I've observed my own son and how his hours are. His younger brother's now out of Tech and could have played football out there and chose not to. He went into Rush last week. He's a fight out now. He's out there. He said, "Dad, I've met 1,000 young ladies out here, and my son Adam playing football has no idea. He's got one girlfriend, and he's like, that's the only person I know here. You know, two different lives."
Well, I don't know. He's putting all his time maybe into the right thing right now, into that fraternity.
He figured out what a mixer was. I mean,
yeah, mixers take time, you know? Yeah, they take a personal commitment if you're going to do it right.
I'm trying to convince Andy now to make sure that mixers and time commitment don't interfere with classwork.
Uh-huh. Donovan Warren defensively on that last play. There's a flag down.
Pass interference by the defense. Number 6. Automatic first down at the spot of the foul.
Well, that's 3 penalties on Warren, who has covered people like a blanket so far in this game, but a little too closely the last couple of times. 2 pass interference calls and a personal foul call against the junior from Long Beach, California.
The words used in our meetings with the coaches about Warren was a steady force back there. Obviously, he's probably lost a little bit of his composure there, and he's got to regain that and be a leader in that secondary, not make those mental mistakes.
West. Well, about 3 of the last 4 or 5 throws that Hiller has made, it looked like he almost had no feeling in his hand. The ball just sort of floated out of there.
Yeah, I'll want to follow this week Western Michigan and the quotes and the comments made about his performance and maybe why the ball was flying out like that. Era.
Because it's not windy. Certainly, moisture is not a problem. Out of the eye here on 2nd and 1. Hiller straight down the middle on the post. To the 1-yard touchdown, 73 yards. Nothing wrong with that throw, was there?
Erase that editorial thought for the newspapers this week. So much for any problems with his hands and the grip.
Yeah, forget what I
said, will you?
Yeah, both of us. And this all starts with protection in the pocket, the ability to step up and make a throw down the field. And for Michigan, one of those deals where they're going to go back and say, hey, look, we got a freshman in there, JT Floyd, number 12, playing, maybe didn't get back deep enough, wasn't playing his role.
Flag down. They blew the whistle before the kick was made.
Snap infraction by the offense. 5-yard penalty. Replay the try.
That'll move them back for John Potter. Nunez, 6 catches, now 122 yards. And that was after he dropped the first two, and a beautiful throw by Hiller.
Absolutely, Mike, and those are the things as a coach and a player you remember, or the drops early in the game when it could have made a difference.
Right. Potter converts. And finally, something good happens for Western Michigan. But they're still down 31-7 on the road.
ESPN's College Football on ABC, brought to you by Under Armour. Experience Under Armour's fastest generation of cleats. Bud Light, with just the right taste that never fills you up. The difference is drinkability. City never sleeps. And the Home Depot, more saving, more doing. That's the power of the Home Depot.
How is that for a sweet indoor practice facility, which they will probably need desperately in about a month? I mean, the weather is really nice now, but we're in Michigan.
And the top of their beam, 85 feet on the inside of that, which has become an important number because of the Cowboys stadium, right?
That's right.
They're at 90 feet getting hit, but we watched a punt inside yesterday, and nobody was hitting the roof in there. That's a fantastic structure.
Well, you know, every punter that goes there, the first thing you're going to try to do is hit the bottom of that video board.
Screaming money around this place.
Yes, sir.
Takes a shot at the 29-yard line. Quint Kessenich is working the sidelines for us. Let's go down to him right now. Quint?
Mike, the issue with Tim Hiller earlier on that last possession was the football being an early game of the year. The new footballs are extremely slippery. So he came off the sideline really upset and irate with the ball boys. Said, guys, give me some of the older footballs. They have better grip. Pretty simple.
Wow. Good job, Quint. I mean,
what?
That
means
we
were right.
Something was wrong.
That's unusual.
Yeah.
Denard Robinson in to run this series. So it certainly looked like something was wrong. And if you've ever grabbed a new football, you can tell how slick they really are. No, it's good to know it wasn't an injury.
Yeah, absolutely.
The young man is a valuable future property. He's got quite a career ahead of him. Robinson reverses his field. You can tell this is a young man whose first instinct is to take off. If he looks downfield and the throw isn't there, he's gone.
Now, great setup there, partner, because you know what? He does miss it. Denard Robinson on the outside, top right side of your screen, receiver wide open. Plenty of field, lots of sideline area to throw the ball. Should have let it go, and he just didn't do it.
Looks to the sideline. This is part of the system. They see what the defense is trying to do against the way they're set up, and they signal in certain changes. Robinson very slippery. Now let's check in with Matt Weiner. He's in New York.
All right, Mike, this time last year, Nick Saban's Alabama team stunned a top 10 team from the ACC when they dominated Clemson. Virginia Tech is on the agenda tonight, our first ABC primetime Saturday night game of the season.
Boy, in Alabama and Virginia Tech, two teams are going to really play some defense. And Virginia Tech, one of the best special teams under Frank Beamer in the history of college football. Beautiful kick. West lets it go, and it just creeps into the end zone. 66 yards off the foot of Zoltan Mesko. Don't mess with the Zoltan. To say the least, 2008 was a trying time for Rich Rodriguez and his Wolverines. Among the lowlights, a loss at home to MAC program Toledo, a program that won three games all year. A decisive loss to rival Ohio State, the Buckeyes won their annual showdown 42-7, and a five-game losing streak and seven defeats in its last eight added up to a 3-9 record in 2008. It was Michigan's first losing season since 1967. The most losses the program had ever sustained, and broke a ridiculously long streak of years with bowl games. But it may not be totally forgotten, but it would be forgiven based on what has happened so far today. It is a new year in Ann Arbor.
And it's a new old football for Tim Miller.
Yeah. Give me that old ball.
He got rid of the old slick football, and the old football, that new old one, is working out nicely for the arm.
Another completion to Nunez, this of 29 yards. And Nunez, after a poor start, now up to 151 yards passing. It's the kind of thing that NFL kickers complain about, because they have the kicking balls for place kicks and punts. And you just hear these guys whine and moan all the time about how hard and how slick they are.
Yeah, you know, here's the ball. One comes out slippery, and it's gone. And now he doesn't have the laces. Ball's gone. Even the receiver can't hold on to the football. So now you come out and you got one that barely has the white on that you play P for K with on Thanksgiving afternoon.
Yeah, that one qualifies as used, doesn't it? So even the ball boys are important. Pillars throws complete. Arnheim spun down at the 40-yard line.
So add another element to coaching intelligence required. Know your balls, right? Know the footballs. Know what you're putting on the field.
First down at the 39. The Broncos in scoring territory again. But the only thing that's been produced is that long one. And there's a fumble after a huge collision. The ball's loose, and Michigan has it. Boy, Brandon West would just drill that time.
Yeah, you know what? There's this Michigan defense flying around the football. When the ball's on the ground, you're able to capitalize on an opportunity when you're around it. It hits the ground. Michigan's defense there to stop a pretty nice little drive going by Western Michigan. Too bad for Tim Hiller. Too bad for Western Michigan. West got a hold on to the football, getting popped hard down the field.
ABC Wednesday, September 23rd. Just because they're all related doesn't mean they always relate. It's one big straight, gay, multicultural, traditional, happy family comedy. Modern Family, the series premiere Wednesday, September 23rd at 9, 8 Central. Part of ABC Comedy Wednesday on ABC.
That's one phase of the Michigan offense today that you could maybe work a little bit on. I want to see some more from is the running game.
But don't you think that will come as the offense itself, this option offense, becomes more expansive? Mm-hmm. Forcier, the quarterback. There's a straight old I formation handoff.
Oh, absolutely.
Absolutely. The success, the balance that they're providing today is going to enable that ground game to really flourish. But the Michigan offensive line, today they've not been beaten with bad assignments, or missed assignments, blown assignments. Nobody's run clean from that Western Michigan defense.
Vincent Smith getting a chance to play tailback. Kevin Grady, number 24, is the fullback. And it will be third and about a yard. Smith straight ahead has the first down. Pritchard made the tackle. Now for SportsCenter right now, here's Matt Weiner from New York.
All right, Mike, the first true freshman quarterback to start a season opener for USC has had a good debut. Matt Barkley hit on 15 of his 19 passes for 233 yards and his first career touchdown pass. All Trojans, who you'll see at Ohio State next Saturday night on ESPN.
That's going to be interesting, isn't it? Smith is Michigan just working on the clock out the midfield with 5:17 to go in this game and a 31-7 score.
Now, anybody who doubted that USC would be good again with Matt Barkley, a freshman at quarterback. How about this? A couple of freshmen, big-time impacts that we've seen today. Matt Barkley out with USC. Tate Forcier here with Michigan.
That's
on big
right.
programs. Georgia getting whipped at Oklahoma State, or handled by Oklahoma State. And they've got a senior but an unproven, inexperienced guy.
And I don't care who Pete Carroll names as his starting quarterback. Kid's going to be good.
Well, I talked to his coaches out there, and they just can't believe the maturity level that he has, his decision-making. He doesn't make mistakes. We all know they've got great players that have been waiting to get their turn.
Yeah.
They've got running backs, all the offensive line back. Receivers are there, the defense, they're going to just reload. So USC is going to be another force to be reckoned with. Anybody who picks Cal to win the Pac-10 out there is throwing mud against the ball. That's a guess.
It's not sticking for me.
No.
I'll take USC. You can have everybody else. It'd be an easy choice. Single setback is Grady, and he'll get the carry. Lowers his shoulder and pounds his way for a first down just inside the 42-yard line.
And you know, the guy who played quarterback in the past at Michigan has always been kind of the focal point. Tate Forcier is going to get a lot of special attention based on the performance today.
Sure.
But this isn't about Tate Forcier. It seems and feels like an offensive unit with 11 guys, unlike Pat White. Pat White was the guy at West Virginia.
Well, wasn't he ever. Forcier on the play fake.
Davis put that on the show late tonight on the highlight reel. Man, what a catch.
Like it was a peach.
Oh, beautiful.
Straight up the middle, 5-6 yards for Kevin Grady. This thing just snatched out of the air.
It just snatched out of the air. But again, Coger makes a great catch. But Forcier was very deliberate, allowed the play to develop. And then his receiver goes up, makes a great catch.
I mean, that's not a tip. It's just a one-handed catch.
That's like that commercial we've been seeing with the glue on the gloves or whatever whatever it is.
Michigan now able to run at will as Michael Shaw out of Trotwood, Ohio, takes it close to the 10.
Well, Michigan
will be another first down.
Michigan's coaching staff, they'll have to erase this. I'd walk in the locker room, I'd say, guys, it's over with. We won, we had a nice ball game, great work, way to get ready, but it's Notre Dame week. Right, we're a young team. We have to have the same intensity at practice as we did last week. Coaches told us on Tuesday they had their best practice of the year. Very intense.
And as you saw, this is the best rushing day they have had in the Rich Rodriguez era, and that takes in all last year. Let the clock run down to 2:11. Rich Rodriguez wants a timeout. call his ball club together. Let's take a look at our Pacific Life game summary. And of course, we told you three quarterbacks would play for Michigan. They have, but Forcier has had the lion's share of it. And he has come through in style. Three touchdowns, ran the ball well, too. Made really good decisions for the most part. And then we got to see the young man they call Shoelace, Denard Robinson, with that blinding speed. It's a play he lost the snap. Rich Rodriguez even said he went the wrong way. You go the wrong way that fast, it's the right way.
Again, I feel like if I were coaching Michigan offensively, I'd find a way to put Denard Robinson on the field more than the times that he's just playing quarterback. That just puts so much pressure on a defense to have to deal with his speed. Absolutely. Wherever he's lined up.
And now we've got a fourth quarterback. David Cone, the junior, will come in and get a chance to run the ball club on first and goal from just inside the 10-yard line. Well, good luck. Michael Shaw just got blown up. And it was Cody Selinski, all 6'2", 277 pounds of him, who obviously slipped a block and just laid it to the ball carrier.
Western Michigan's had a better effort in the second half.
Surrey? Absolutely. They looked so out of sync in the first half. No rhythm. They played tentatively, I thought, on both sides of the ball. Shaw, the tailback, he'll get the carry again. Good blocking for him this time. And he got back to the 10-yard line, so it will be third and goal. Clock continues to run. Keep in mind, a lot of people thought Western Michigan, they were about a two-touchdown underdog coming into this ballgame, that they would be very competitive. And some people thought they had a shot to pull an upset, especially with all the distractions that were going on with the Michigan program this week. It has not turned out that way. Michigan has been very, very focused. Third and goal, Cone on a busted play, throws for the end zone, incomplete. He turned around to pitch it, and there was nobody home, and this might be offensive interference or holding down at the goal line. Well, that's a lonely feeling for a quarterback. You turn around to pitch it, and the guy's not there. Then you get to take a big bite of it. Oh, that's going to be offensive interference. Now, what do you do? Back him up third and 20 or fourth and goal from the 10?
I decline it.
I
give him another chance.
Pass interference by the offense, number 18. That penalty is declined. Fourth down.
Penalty called on James Rogers, a junior wide receiver. I think he was still under the impression it was a running play, and he was blocking at the goal line.
Absolutely.
But because the ball was thrown, he ends up being called for interference. Not really his fault. Now, fourth and goal with 44 seconds left in the game. And Cone will go to the shotgun and have a chance to throw a touchdown pass to the end zone and out of the back of the end zone, incomplete. So they turn it over and downs. It was intended for Michael Cox, a redshirt freshman. Tonight on ABC, you'll see two top 10 powerhouses, number 5 Alabama, number 7 Virginia Tech. They'll collide in the Chick-fil-A kickoff game presented by Southwest Airlines. The Chick-fil-A kickoff game, part of Dick's Sporting Goods kickoff week tonight at 8 o'clock Eastern on ABC. And that is a ball game fit for prime time.
All right, so the quarterback theme that we were talking about earlier, we had it here with Tate Forcier. You've got Barkley out at USC. Greg McElroy tonight, debut really for Alabama, right? A very key new member of college football and how how it ends this year.
Because you know that defense is a championship outfit.
Yeah, absolutely. And before we leave this game, just want to say again, Western Michigan, hats off to them. 79 yards offense in the first half. They come up with 218 in the second.
Yeah.
And they hold Michigan to no points.
So that's not bad.
That's character.
Yes, it is.
That's good coaching, and that's character.
Great point. Alex Carter is the quarterback. Redshirt freshman, big future in front of him, 6'2", 224. And Carter throws a complete pass as the game ends. All the weight in the world must be lifted off the Michigan coaches and players' shoulders as they get to play a ball game and quit reading the newspapers. And they win 31-7 over Western Michigan, a team that is expected to contend for the MAC title and a team that was expected to come in here and play them very, very well. But Michigan was the dominant ball club. You got to take your hats off to the guys in blue, and let's check in with Quint.
Coach, it's been an emotional week for you. What is most satisfying right now as you stand on this field?
Well, just for our young men, they'd be happy. They've worked extremely hard. They stayed focused. We got a great group of young guys, and not happy with it. We play in the second half, but it's a nice victory for our seniors and for our great crowd.
How do you explain that focus right in the face of distraction?
Well, our guys, you know, we've been focused for 9 months now, and so I don't think anything's going to happen to take our guys off that focus. So we got a lot of work to do. We got a great club coming in here next week.
That first half by Tate Forcier in his debut, how do you best characterize what you saw from your young quarterback?
I think he played mature beyond his years, and he made some mistakes, but he'll keep getting better, as will Denard and the rest of our guys, and we're excited to get back to work.
Coach, you said you didn't get any sleep this week. Is tonight a night perhaps you'll get some sleep?
I hope. If I get 2 or 3 hours, I'll be happy.
Thanks, Coach. Mike.
He won't sleep.
No, probably not, but for a good reason this time. What is the one thing you're going to take away from this opening day win?
Our question at the beginning of the show, would the distractions at Michigan this previous week be a stumbling block or a building block? I'm taking away that it's a building block.
I think it's a great evaluation. And a smile from Rich Rodriguez as he entered the interview with Quint. Gets a huge ovation from the Michigan fans waiting for him. Once again, the final score, Michigan 31 and Western Michigan 7. For Craig James and Quint Kesenich and our entire ABC crew, this is Mike Patrick. Thanks for watching, everybody. Stay tuned for the complete post-game report from our Times Square studio after this word from our ABC station.